just like to welcome those who just watched Northern Illinois beat Ball State. We're here in Grambling, Louisiana. Texas Southern in the white jerseys. The quarterback, Arvell Nelson, getting a first down for the Texas Southern Tigers all the way down to the Grambling 23-yard line. No score in the game. First possession for Texas Southern. Grambling had the ball first after the opening kickoff and went three and out. And now Texas Southern got the ball in great field position at the 49 of Grambling. They have it. First down and 10. Charlie Neal along with Jay Walker. Glad you could join us. Some exciting football on the U tonight. A MAC contest from to a SWAC contest. And here we are. Play action for Nelson going to his right. Being chased. Gets it away and it's complete but out of bounds on the far sideline. On the receiving end was Brian Haith. You spoke of him as one of our impact players, Jay.
Yeah, you know, he's a big target there on the outside. And if they can get him to make some plays, the senior from Upland, California, he's their go-to wide receiver. Arvell Nelson seems to have a little comfort zone with Haith there on the outside. And one thing I will say for this Texas Southern team, for a team that's been dominated by Grambling, as it has for the past decade or so, they're showing no fear tonight. They're taking it right to the Tigers on this opening drive.
So it'll bring up a second and 10 now. Nelson from the shotgun decides to keep it on the ground this time. Gilbert on the carry. Not much running room for Martin Gilbert. You look at the defensive starters for Grambling across the top of your screen. Number 16 there, that's TJ McCord. They have some pretty good defensive players back there. Christian Anthony, one of the leading candidates for the Buchanan Awards, which goes to the top defensive player in the FCS.
He's a fantastic football player. Christian Anthony goes 6'4", 250 pounds. He's what you want in that defensive end position. He's a straight-up 4-3 defensive end, can cause havoc in the running game as well as the passing game.
Play action to Gilbert. Nelson under pressure, and he is being sacked in the backfield by Exuma. Cliff Exuma, number 50, the redshirt sophomore from North Miami Beach, the leading tackler on this Grambling team.
And you'll see him coming from his middle linebacker spot. Once the quarterback decides to cut back into the middle, good job by Cliff Exuma playing that spy backer. When you get a sack like that, you've got to give credit to the defensive ends, and that's Jamarcus Savage as well as Christian Anthony. They did not allow the quarterback to break the pocket. So once the quarterback realized he couldn't get outside, he had to step up, and right there was Cliff Exuma.
A loss of 6 on the play. They're going to go for it. On fourth down, it'll be 4th and 14. If they kick the field goal, it would be a 45-yard field goal attempt. Standing in there, the quarterback, he fumbles the ball, and it's recovered by Texas Southern, fortunately. But they turn it over on downs, and the man who came in, I'm trying to see who got his hands on the football, it was recovered by Charles Smith there, preseason all-conference selection number 72. In the meantime, 10:22. That's the time remaining. No score here in Grambling. No score here, Grambling, Louisiana, between these two Western Division opponents. Both Tigers. Dillon, the pass out in the flat. Quick one to Pippen. And Pippen has run out of bounds after about a 4-yard gain. Offensive alignment. The starting lineups for Grambling State University will be at the top of your screen. Their starting offense. Greg Dillon is the quarterback. You look at Walker, one of the running backs in the backfield. Dante Cheek is a fullback. And right now, they've got a fire drill going on back
look
there.
At this formation.
We know that they like the Wildcat every now and then, and now they decide to keep it on the ground with Kenneth Baptiste. On the carry, and he goes around the left side. He's out of Lafayette, Louisiana. Last year against Texas Southern, 3 carries, 29 yards. Oh, he has seen some action and has seen some action this year. Still has not scored a touchdown rushing and does have a touchdown receiving to his credit. But it is a third down for the Grambling Tigers, who came into the game ranked 5th in the conference in third down conversions at 34%. Smith in motion.
Pressure coming.
And in and out of the hands of Jesse Smith, the senior from Monroe, Louisiana. He was the intended receiver there. So Greg Dillon may have put a little bit too much of a mustard on that throw.
Yeah, the ball definitely had plenty of velocity on it, but that's one where for Jesse Smith, you got to make that catch and realize when you're the hot read, although you're catching the ball short of the first down marker, with man-to-man coverage, all you have to do is make one guy miss, and that could be a big play opportunity.
So the second three and out for Grambling State. They'll punt it away. Darryl Glasper is one man deep to receive it, along with Richard Samuel. It'll be Glasper at the 30-yard line. There's a timeout on the field. Meanwhile, ESPNU's coverage of college football continues Friday night as the Temple Owls facing the Zips of Akron. College football primetime on ESPNU and ESPNU HD Friday at 8:30 p.m. Eastern. More information, log on to ESPNU.com.
When's the last time the Temple won a football game? Now the question is, when's the last time Temple lost a football game?
It's been a while. They lost to Villanova early in the season as they get this pass complete. That's Joe Anderson. Seven straight wins for the Owls of Temple from Philadelphia. So they're doing pretty good over their Mid-American Conference and trying to wrap things up and get to Detroit to that championship game.
Yeah, take a look at the quick pass out here to Joe Anderson, showing you some athletic ability, the wide receiver there. And, you know, you talk about that Temple ball squad. If Brian Kelly wasn't having the success he was having in Cincinnati, I would give Al Golden Coach of the Year. But I think you got to give it to Cincinnati if they went out.
Here again, the quarterback, Nelson, out of Cleveland, Ohio, went to Glenville High in Cleveland. Transferred in from Fort Scott, Kansas Community College, his first year here. And it's a third down and one facing Texas Southern. They're going with the no-huddle offense. And the quarterback keeps it, trying to get to the first down marker. Did he get there? Let's see where they mark it. It's going to be very, very close. On the quarterback keeper, Arvell Nelson, number four in the SWAC as far as passing is concerned. Two-time SWAC newcomer of the year this season. And they got it.
One of the difficulties I had, and Arvell had the same problem, when you're 6'4" and above trying to get quarterback sneak, you've got to stay low. You know, you've got to almost help your lineman with that nudge. And you see on that quarterback sneak attempt there, he was kind of high and got held up, and you lose your leverage. So next time you get that sneak, get low, fella. You become that six offensive lineman and push.
This is a team, this Texas Southern team, that has not had a winning record since 2000. That's when they went 8-3 overall, 5-1 in the conference under Bill Thomas. There's a pass. They had a man open, but was thrown behind Ricky Dixon, the intended receiver. He came in, that is Nelson, about 59% of his passes he completed this year.
And in this type of offense, you know, for the Johnny Cole type offense with the hobo attack, you know, you need your passer to be 65-70%. And that's one of those things where he's got to hit that pass. You got a guy open in the curl. He's just throwing football besides a hitch pattern. You've got to be able to complete that pass.
Little flanker screen on the far side. And maybe about 7 yards on the reception.
See the job there that was done. You know, they're going to take advantage of everything the defense gives them. And Nelson gets under the center right away to get rid of the ball quickly so he can get the ball in the hands of a playmaker. And they're always looking to attack. And had Lance Castleberry not been there from that inside linebacker spot, that would have been a bigger play.
Trips receivers on the near side. And now wide open middle for the quarterback who stumbles forward across midfield for the first down. So Arvell Nelson, seeing the wide open middle, took advantage of it.
Did you see the quickness in the decision? I mean, take a look at this. 1, 2, 3, it's not there, I'm gone. You know, he didn't even have time to plant. He knew how many yards he needed, saw the defensive line just open up like the Red Sea, and he took advantage of it.
Second down, now they're going to blow the whistle. Somebody was moving prematurely because they may have had six on that play. This one's coming back. That was Joseph Warren, the tailback.
That's a timeout.
It was a timeout by Grambling.
Grambling, slow down. This is like the old Benjo basketball offense. They are getting up to the line of scrimmage and calling plays in bunches, and they need to think about it.
7:09 remaining here, first quarter. We'll be back to Grambling in a moment. ESPNU College Football Primetime brought to you by the Home Depot. Visit homedepot.com. More saving, more doing. That's the power of the Home Depot. Along with Jay Walker, I'm Charlie Neal. Glad you could join us for Thursday night primetime college football. We're in the heart of SWAC country. It's Texas Southern against Grambling. No score here. Texas Southern with the ball. First down and 10 across midfield into Grambling territory at the 48-yard line. Arvell Nelson out of Cleveland, Ohio, is the quarterback working under center this time. Lone setback is Martin Gilbert. Grambling had to call a timeout to slow down this train that was running away from him, it looked like, for a moment. There on the sideline, has it complete for a first down and a good catch over the shoulder by Anderson. Joe Anderson, the sophomore out of Texas, Arcana, Texas, his 32nd reception of the year.
Yeah, when you've got a go-to wide receiver with athleticism, then it's a pleasure to have. And you see Desmond Leonard there playing bump and run coverage. No competition for Joe Anderson.
And now they keep the ball on the ground with Gilbert on the carry straight ahead. You talk about Desmond Leonard. Here's a young man who led the SWAC in interceptions a year ago with just 6. And we talked about it in the open, Jay, a little bit, what the difference this year makes. Leonard only 1 interception to his credit this year.
And normally if you've got a defensive line that's really good and aggressive, then that means the defensive back can take more chances, be more aggressive. And we know Christian Anthony's a great football player, but they lost 2 interior linemen that really allowed them to control the line of scrimmage that required double teams last year. Now teams are just double teaming Christian Anthony, and the opposing quarterbacks are having more time to throw the football.
This time, Nelson, what a bullet he threw in there. That may be a touchdown.
It is a touchdown. And that is a big
bullet. Joe Anderson on the reception for the touchdown, and that's his 4th reception of a touchdown this year. Nelson with his 9th touchdown pass. What a bullet he threw.
Yeah, this is a skinny post, and watch him set and fire. And a good job by Anderson of shielding himself in between the defensive back and the quarterback. If Desmond Leonard was going to make a play, he was going to have to come through Joe Anderson. Anderson ran a nice route, that skinny post, and that was one of the best passes I've seen all year.
It certainly was.
Quarterback.
Well, that looked like a Peyton Manning pass, didn't it?
Oh, that was right on time. I mean, woo. Can't throw any better.
Here's the point after for Hurst. She is 18 of 20 this year, and they fumbled the snap, and now the holder is trying to make something happen, and it won't. But it's still a 6-0 Texas Southern lead. The holder, Stephon Solomon, who is also the punter, and a bad snap, but it's 6-0. Joe Anderson in the end zone. Reservations for 6.
Channel 276.
89. Jordan.
Along with Jay Walker, Charlie Neal, 6-0. Texas Southern just getting on the board. The ocean of soul is here, along with the motion of the ocean, but they put some motion in place this time.
Yeah, let's take a look why that touchdown worked. Number 89, left side of your screen, is Jonathan Curtin, the tight end. Watch him on the clear out route. His job is to run to be covered by the inside linebacker, so the quarterback has a nice lane to deliver that touchdown pass to Joe Anderson. If he takes an outside release or gets bumped too far outside, he would have been in the throwing lane. That's how you know they've got an efficient passing game. When guys are doing their job, we call it running to be covered. If you have 2 people cover you, that means you've got one-on-one on the outside. Good coaching, good execution by Jordan Curtin.
Derek Wilhite. Bell deep to receive the kick by Hurst. It'll be Bell at the 11-yard line. Bell up the seam, has a running rope, and the kicker finally had to knock him out of bounds. Hurst, but not before a good return all the way to the 46, about a 35-yard return.
Yeah, you'll see this wedge right here. They do the wedge, and they've got the return right. Look at that. You got that much daylight. Thank goodness they've got a kicker that's an aggressive, can go over there and make that tackle, and Robert Hurst, or else he was going to the end zone. And something you got to be concerned about if you're Texas Southern. If you're coming in here to Grambling, you're trying to pull the upset, you've got to win on offense, defense, and special teams. Right now, their special teams missed an extra point, as well as they just gave up a big kick return.
So from their own 47-yard line, but not any running room this time as they try to take Warren to the left side, and a good pursuit by Rolando Melancon. Number 99 defensively for the Tigers of Texas Southern, who came into the game with 5 tackles for loss Just add one more to that. A loss that time of 9 yards.
Yeah, when you can get an interior lineman, especially a defensive tackle, getting the back behind the opposing team's line of scrimmage, that means you have an opportunity to control in the line of scrimmage.
Now, this is the third offensive possession for Grambling today, and they've been three and out in their first two possessions. Not something indicative of a Greg Dillon-led team.
You know, they haven't had an opportunity to get control of this. Normally, Grambling wins with great defense, and they allow the offense to kind of just feel their way out while the defense starts to dominate. This case here, the defense hasn't been able to slow down. The hobo.
The hobo, high-octane, big offense, right? Don't forget the college basketball early signing period has been Eastern on ESPN UHD. I don't think he's going to Howard, is he?
He should. He has any sense.
It is second down at 19. Texas Southern showing a little blitz, and they come out of it. The pass is incomplete on the near side. Trying to get it to one of the wide receivers. And that goes out of bounds. A flag on the play. And it looks like it may be against Texas Southern. We're going to have offsides. No, it's more than that. There's a pass interference. A referee, I did not hear him say anything. That is Charles Lewis. But that's the first down for Grambling today, and they're across midfield for the first time in Texas Southern territory at the 47-yard line.
And that's unfortunate because they played very well so far in this first quarter, but don't allow a team to get a first down by a penalty.
There's Dillon running for about 8 yards. Down inside the 40 to about the 37, 38-yard line. Greg Dillon, who has scored touchdowns rushing this year 4 times.
Let's take a look at the read and progression here. Greg Dillon, 1, 2, me. That's what they call it. He said, our progressions are simple. We go 1, 2, me.
If it's not there after the second one, I take off and run with it.
And that's what a defensive coach would tell his quarterback to do.
They'll give him a 7-yard gain on that last run. Make it second down and 3. Wants to go upstairs under pressure now. Being chased. Finally gets it off. Has it complete. Inside the 25. Down to the 24-yard line. On the reception. Big number 84 for Grambling State University. And that is Ryan Allen out of New Orleans, Louisiana.
I think in that last one, we saw 1, 2, me, back to 2. Because he wanted to scramble.
Well, I'll tell you, he really took a pop after he let that ball go, but Allen was there to make the reception. So it's first down and 10, Grambling moving. That was a 15-yard pass completion. And here we go again, coming to the near side this time is Walker, and Walker is stopped in the backfield. And that was Jashad Gaines that came up to make the stop defensively for Texas Southern.
Yeah, good job by Gaines, that weak-side linebacker there. Don't allow any running back to get outside. If you're an outside linebacker, you never give up outside contain.
He lost a yard on that play, too. Now penalty marker goes down. Offsides against the defense. So it's a 5-yard penalty. Another penalty keeps the ball moving for Grambling.
This is going to be a very interesting contest because it really seems as if both these offenses are trying to wear the other defense out. I mean, they're both getting up to the line. They're doing no huddle. We've had a number of plays called, and you would have had this many plays called in almost a whole half. We're still in the first quarter, and both teams are stepping on the gas pedal.
Under 4 minutes to go, 3:45 to be exact. Fifth play of the drive for Grambling. Again, here's the quarterback, Dillon. He puts Walker behind him now. Now he's got the option. And he took a shot.
Incoming.
He took a shot from Shamari Clemens, number 17 there, the sophomore out of West Monroe, Louisiana, right down the road about 40 miles from here.
Yeah, you know, the old incoming call, when it's there so quick, just duck. And I give credit to Dillon. Rather than trying to pitch the ball, realize he's going to get hit, just minimize your losses.
Now we got, who was drawn off, or was it offsides on the defense? It's against the defense. That's the second offsides penalty. So this is the third penalty of this drive against Texas Southern. We had a pass interference. And we've had two offsides.
And that's something where this team has room to improve upon. You know, you can tell these guys can play. They can play with Grambling. But when you're going against a good program and a well-coached team, you can't give them anything or else they'll take advantage of it. And that's what Grambling is doing on this drive.
And Texas Southern is the most penalized team in the SWAC, averaging over 100 yards in penalties a game. And so it's showing up right here on this drive as Dylan tries the option to the left side, being chased
not
over there.
It.
And it's strung out pretty good by the defense of white jerseys of Texas Southern. They did a good job. Kadarian Williams, one of them there, number 13. Dwan Fulgham, the linebacker, number 44. A preseason all-conference selection who's ranked in the nation 20th in tackles for losses.
And this is one of those true Texas teams. They got Texas athletes on that field, and they can run and they can hit. You saw it on that last one. When you've got a team that is that fast and that athletic, you can't run out side to side. Don't try and stretch it. You need to play some power football.
37-yard field goal by Ari Johnson. His longest this year is 47. This one is up. It has the distance, and it's good. And we have 3 points on the board for the Tigers of Grambling. The freshman out of Corona, California, puts three on the board for the Tigers. 6-3. Our score here with 2:03 left in the first quarter. ESPN fans, help us to get to 10,000 fans on Facebook. Just log on to Facebook today. Search ESPNU and become a fan, and we'll keep you updated on news, provide lively discussions, and show you photos on the air. Who wants to be our 10,000th fan? Hey, so we've got some Facebook questions for you coming up.
Well, we got some things that'll get some fans out there. We may make a couple enemies too, but we've got some things that we can do. Asking some questions, some things I want to know. The professor wants to know a couple things. One thing I like about, you see the Grambling band here, you know, so often we just give credit to the football team on the field, but you can tell when an administration starts to get it when on a Thursday night, Texas Southern brought their band out
right
to support their football team. The easy thing would have been, hey, we're going on the road, it's Thursday, we're not going to go. But they want to support their squad, and the university is getting behind this football team. That's a good sign of life that we haven't seen down there in that part of Houston, Texas in quite some time.
Well, you're right about that, Jay. And like you said, it's about a five-hour drive from Houston down here to
say the band name, Charles. Let me hear you say the band name. Texas Southern.
The Oceans of Soul.
Oceans of Soul.
Oceans of Soul. Whoa, a fumble. And finally picked up at the 30-yard line, averting disaster down there for Texas Southern was Joe Anderson, the wide receiver, number one.
You know, you see here, you know, bad things happen to them when those upbacks try to field the kick, and they never fielded it cleanly, and they should just fall on it right there. Somebody needs to fall on it. Right when the return man was trying to fall of it, Joe Anderson said, hey, give me this thing. I'll pick up a couple yards.
So for the second straight possession, Texas Southern starts at their own 30, their last drive ended in a touchdown on a touchdown pass from the quarterback Nelson to Joe Anderson. Nelson back to pass with a little pressure now. He's going to be dropped back at the line of scrimmage. No running room there. Going to bring up second down and 10. It looks like Antoine Rogers was the man there defensively for the Grambling Tigers, number 98.
But more importantly, what they were able to do was get to the quarterback with the four-man pass rush. No need to blitz. Let the front four take on their five and get to the quarterback.
Little swing pass knocked in the air. 91 with the hands on it. Kendall Robinson, the junior from Birmingham, Alabama's Parker High, tapped it in the air.
And that's what you want, recognition. Get upfield. The moment you see the quarterback get ready to throw and you can't get there, jump. The Daddy Mac will make you jump. Jump.
It'll bring up a third down situation for the Tigers of Texas Southern, who've done a pretty good job in that department tonight. They are 2 of 3 in third down conversions. Six in the conference in that department coming in. And now we had two men moving, I believe, at the same time. So therefore, we're going to get a false start.
And see, these are the me penalties. Mm-hmm. You know, we call the me penalties the mental errors, things that you can correct. They have nothing to do with what your opponent is doing to you. It's just a matter of having the discipline and realizing, hey, this is how we're going to shift from a formation. Don't jump off sides. Those are mental errors. They're not physical errors. they've got to reduce the me penalty before they really want to be a good football club.
Third down, 15 now. Quarterback.
Look out.
Is his arm going forward or not? It's picked up by Christian Anthony. Anthony taking it back down the field. Anthony still on his feet. Will not give it up. And has finally dropped at the 12-yard line. He's already returned two interceptions this year for touchdowns. And I think it's going to be Grambling's football defense. We said would play the part at the beginning. There you are, Jay.
Hey! You going to come to me? Come to me. But what an effort there by Christian Anthony. I mean, you got to wonder schematically. You don't leave a guy like him as active. I understand sometimes if you're rolling away from the quarterback, but they left him unblocked. Number 90, watch him. Unblocked, gets around there. You can't pull up if he's going to be unblocked. And he comes from behind, gets the strip, gets the fumble recovery, and he was heading to the end zone. And look at this. Once they touch him, no arm tackles. You're not going to arm tackle him.
They call him Mr. Justice, and there's a touchdown into the end zone. On the running play is Frank Warren. Frank Warren, the junior out of Pleasant Grove, Alabama, with his fifth rushing touchdown this year. So just like that, Grambling takes the lead.
Yeah, that's got to hurt there. And they're doing that little option play, and you give it to the dive man. In that case there, Frank Warren going right up the middle. And the defense helped jumpstart the offense, gave him that spark. And now all of a sudden, Texas Southern, they're going to be down by more than a field goal if they make this extra point.
Ari Johnson, who has not missed a PAT this year, puts it through, and it's a 10-6 ball game. Grambling with a minute to go in the first quarter. So there he is. He wants to be a judge. And they call him, they say justice is served. Well, justice was served that time, and a lot of miscues by Texas Southern in the first quarter alone, and most of them have been penalties.
Yeah, we talk about, you know, the penalties, the mental errors, going there, taking the sack, that'll happen. That's a physical error, but missing an assignment and allowing your quarterback to get hit from the backside, then you don't get the point after. Come on now, you've got to be able to do that one. And they played sloppy, and the tough thing about it is this football team physically could be better than Grambling from what we've seen thus far, but hey, Grambling seems to be more discipline right now, and they play an assignment football, and Grambling's got a Christian Anthony, and Texas Southern doesn't.
Well, justice is served. There he is, as you said, Buford T. Justice. That's what you wanted to call him. He's a very admirable young man, and one of the things is he wants to go to he's a criminal justice major, wants to go to law school, wants to become a judge, and he's from Birmingham, Alabama's Carver High. One of the leading candidates for the Buchanan Award is the Defensive Player of the Year in the FCS. On the return for Texas Southern, not much running room for Darryl Glasper, the junior from Baton Rouge, defensive back.
And right now, if you're Texas Southern, I mean, wow, how things can change. They were in control of this football game. They had a chance to go up 7-0. So all starts with that extra point that they botch, and then they give up the big kickoff return, then they give up the penalty to help keep the drive alive, and now all of a sudden, Texas Southern needs to respond right now to Grambling, or else this thing could get ugly quickly.
It certainly could.
I mean, this momentum is just gone from Texas Southern. They need to answer with a big play. Let's see if the hobo can do something.
Well, it looked like he had something going until his arm was hit that time, and this time nothing going on. That's big number 51, Charlie Brewer, the nose tackle, there to make the stop. Also, Christian Anthony in there, preseason all-SWAC player, number 90. And, you know, we talk about Christian Anthony. He's the preseason defensive player of the year in the Southwestern Athletic Conference, and he has not disappointed. He's lived up to his numbers this year. We saw him pick up the fumble, run it back to the 14-yard line. He's intercepted four passes for defensive end, and he's run two back for touchdowns.
That's unheard of. Woo, look at him, and he is just dominating. Oh, my goodness. Did you see that?
No.
Man among boys. You go, boy, like my mom used to say. You go, boy. If you're going to play like that, I'm going to give it up to you.
He had a touchdown against Texas Southern a year ago, 12-yard
Look at
variety.
The swing, running back, get out my way. I'm going to hit your quarterback.
He went through two people.
Did he? And if there would have been a third, he would have gone through him, too. See, that's that motor. That's something that you can't teach. You either have it or you don't. And Christian Anthony has it. I can sit back and just watch a guy like that play all day long.
Against Texas Southern last year, he intercepted a pass and ran it back 12 yards for a touchdown. He has a fumble recovery today, running back to the 14-yard line that set up a touchdown, and now a whistle is going to blow. And again, another penalty, which looks like, well, I don't know who it's going to be whistled against. I'm going to wait.
It's number 72, Charles Smith. And you know what position he plays?
Left tackle.
Left tackle.
False start. That is the sixth penalty of the ball game in the first quarter against Texas Southern, again, for 39 yards.
And that won't show up in the stat sheet. It'll be just a penalty. But
yes, it will, because they're averaging 104 yards of penalties a game.
But the left tackle right now, you know, and this is going to be Houston, we have a problem. And that's where Texas Southern is. Houston, your problem right now is you've got Charles Smith trying to block Christian Anthony. And right now, I'm going to tell you, it's not going to happen.
Look at that one.
They called a screen. Smart play.
And they still can't get it to work.
Oh, that was a great job. This is a well-coached defense. You know,
Cliff Yoshida, the defensive coordinator.
She did a good job. They tried to bait Anthony, come up field hard, let him go. But take a look at number 91, Kendall Robinson. You see him? He knows it's a screen. He grabbed the running back. You're allowed to do that because a screen pass is thrown behind the line of scrimmage. And you can put your hands on him. Once you snip it out, look at him. He's got him, and he's not letting him go. Oh, that's just well-coached.
Kendall Robinson is number 91 you were speaking of. Fourth down now. That brings on the punter for Texas Southern, Stephon Solomon, who's also the holder. And that one was close to being blocked. But what a kick. Boy, you're talking about hang time. Fair catch call for back at the 30-yard line by Kiera Thompson. And that's going to be the end of the first quarter here. Is there a penalty flag down? There is one sitting right at about the 42-yard line. Why not? We've had enough of them so far. Why not end the quarter on one? This is against Grambling. So that's the end of the first quarter after the 46-yard punt by Stephon Solomon. 10-6, our score here in Louisiana. As we start the second quarter here in Grambling, Louisiana, they have the ball, first down and 10. You see the stats in the first quarter, total yards, and there's another penalty marker down. That's the eighth penalty of the ball game, seventh. This one is against Grambling. Second one against them.
What's going on with the left tackle position tonight?
I don't know. Number 66, Victor Phillips there, sophomore from Adamsville, Alabama. You know, you talk about this Grambling team, and, you know, they've kind of had a letdown this year, 11-2 last year, 7-0 in the conference, 5-4 overall this year, 3-2 in the conference. Only five seniors actually contributing. So the majority of these players are going to be back next year, including Christian Anthony.
And that's something I was asking Coach Broadway about, you know, was this a rebuilding process? And coaches say, no, we had enough talent to win. But if you look on paper, when you're that young, it has to be. It has to be. And he did give credit to his team. He said, you know, the Oklahoma State game took a lot out of us. They beat us physically, they beat us mentally, and they beat us psychologically. He was wondering about the team mental strength, and he said they responded well, because they easily could have gone into the tank after that game, but they fought and fought to make this a competitive football season.
Walker, the second back behind his quarterback. Play action now for Dylan, rolling to the left. He wanted to throw to his fullback. Now he takes off and runs out of bounds across the 25 to about the 27-yard line. You know, and one of the things when we talk about him, as you look at this play once again, and Coach Broadway, you know, he was disappointed by the way and things that they did this year and the success they didn't have that he thought he should have. But he also said, as you mentioned, that he felt the game was more mental than a lot of coaches like to admit to. Coaches like to deal with the physical aspects a lot of times rather than dealing with the mental aspects.
And I can agree with that, and I think you're seeing that this evening. I mean, Texas Southern, you can tell these guys are on the field. They play football. Grambling handles the mental aspects of football.
And there's Dylan stumbling forward and close to the first down, right at about the 25-yard line. So that was a third down play, and he stumbled forward and may have got enough for the first down. They may have to measure.
Yeah, you see him, you know, once he gets the ball in the pocket and he's holding down, he's looking down the read. It's not there. The 1-2 me, make one guy miss. And had he been able to keep his balance, he easily would have got the first down, but looks like that knee came down just short of the line. And you get a game like this and your defense is playing pretty well, no questions about it. You got to punt the ball here.
And they're going to punt it from their own 25. This will be Fabian Carter, freshman from Miami, Florida, averaging 35.8 yards per punt. And now another flag goes down. Delay a game or illegal substitution. It's one of the two. Illegal substitution. And it's against Texas Southern. That'll give them a first down. And see, that's and you wonder, you look at Texas Southern, you say, okay, you just came off of a big win against Alcorn. You came off of a big win against Jackson State. You came off a big win against Mississippi Valley. You won three in a row, and you come into a game, and you do this. And there's, you know, coach is trying to get a timeout. He's trying to get a timeout, Johnny Cole, and settle his team down. They've got all kinds of issues over there right now.
Yeah, and that's tough. But, you know, you remember when Joe Taylor first got the job at Florida A&M. And remember we talked about, hey, you got to really look forward to coaching those Florida athletes down there. And he said, well, no. He said, I want disciplined Florida athletes.
Right, that's
and right now I'm seeing now, they've got some athletes at Texas Southern. Where's the football discipline? Yeah. And that's what he's got to instill. And I think Coach Cole, he'll find a way to get it done.
I mean, you're talking about seven penalties already against this team. And they're the mental type penalties that we were talking about. I mean, illegal substitution, offsides, on defense, offsides, jumping offsides, false starts by the offensive lineman. You know, they had, you know, one pass interference penalty, but, I mean, I didn't make that a big deal, but some of those other penalties were just crazy penalties.
Yeah, and they're ones that you see that the teams that are used to winning year in and year out, they don't have those type of penalties, you know. They're not just going to make them an example, but, you know, Joe Taylor's teams don't get those type of penalties. You know, go down to Southern University, Pete Richardson, those teams don't get those type of penalties. They don't hurt themselves.
Right.
They allow their opponents to hurt themselves, and then they inflict some more damage with the things they control in between the whistles.
So they give the team a first down on an illegal substitution penalty just when Grambling was ready to punt the ball away. They get new life, and here's Kira Thompson on the near side, picks up the first down after a 10-yard gain or very close to it on that reception.
I wish that play was out when I was in college, Charlie. I mean, all you do is just take the snap, throw it to a guy behind the line of scrimmage, and he runs for 9 yards and those are free passing stats right there.
They say Thompson may be the best athlete on this Grambling team. That was his 23rd reception of the year. Here's offsides again.
And the guy didn't snap it.
Well, I'll tell you. Discipline, as you said, Jay. Discipline. This time they keep the ball on the ground. That is, Fulgham was right there, number 44, along with Gaines, 29, on the defensive side of the ball. And Jashad Gaines, junior out of Las Vegas, Nevada. Keep the running attack to a minimum. And when we talked to Coach Broadway, one of the things he talked about was, we must stop the run, we must protect the ball, and we must win the kicking game. Well, they've done a pretty good job as Warren catches the handoff from his quarterback, gets about 8-9 yards on the run, and it'll be second down and one.
And right now, mission accomplished by Grambling. When you get the ball pinned in your own side of the field, all you want to do is get the ball to around midfield before you attempt a punt. And no matter what happens with this drive, the Tigers have won.
Here's an option play to the left side to Warren, trying to get to the first down marker, very close to it. We'll see where they mark it. The two-headed monster at quarterback between Warren and Walker, two very good running backs.
Yeah, they both are very similar in their styles and their build. And, you know, I like to look at their average per carry to see if there's really a difference maker. And one averages 5.9 yards a carry. The other averages 5.6. One's got five touchdowns. The other has four touchdowns. So, you know, you talk about you're not missing a step when you've got another running back in there. And they know that. I mean, that way, when you got a guy that's a little dinged up, he's not trying to force himself to stay in there. Hey, come on, man, bring the other guy in. And that's where you can have a real effective running game.
Warren, third leading rusher in the SWAC. Walker, fourth leading rusher in the SWAC. I mean, it's kind of interesting. And Walker came into the season as a preseason second team all-conference selection. As they measure this one, let's see if they got enough. If they're going to be still looking at it. They need a microscope. Just inches before they need a first down. Going to bring up a third down and inches, you know. And the thing about you look at Warren, he came into the game with 709 yards rushing. Grambling has not had a 1,000-yard rusher since Brad Hill back in 2001. And Warren was just 99 yards shy of 1,000 a year ago, while he was also the SWAC Freshman of the Year back in 2007.
You know why they haven't had a 1,000-yard rusher? I mean, Doug Williams is the head coach, and Melvin Spears was the head coach, and Bruce Eugene was a quarterback, so yeah. There was no need to
run the ball.
Randy Himes and all those guys, they were air tiger. Woo, no. No, sir.
Did
no,
not
sir.
Get it. They tried to get to the first down marker to be a fourth down. Now, do you punt it or you do?
Oh, you punt it. You're winning the battlefield position, and you did what you were supposed to do. I said that early in the drive. No matter where the drive stops, you did your job. And look at them get blown off the line. Look at the black. Oh, they're on real estate. They're on roller skates. Reve Smith, the center. You know the snap count. You cannot allow Rolando Melancon to just push you in the back like that. He just bulldozed him.
Michael Shelton also in there, number 91 there. Meanwhile, here's Fabian Carter. He's going to punt it again. Let's see if they give him another first down with a defensive penalty. And it's not funny. I mean, we're not trying to make light of it, but that's the type of night it's been for Texas Southern. Carter, the left-footed punter. Fumbled! Grambling may have it.
They've got it.
A muff punt return.
Oh, no.
Somehow Texas Southern managed to save the day. But that was disaster written all over it. Let's look at it once again.
I've been going there trying to field it.
Yeah, that
just
was Glasper, a veteran, a junior out of Baton Rouge, Louisiana, second in the conference in punt returns. He thought he could get it done, and the day was saved, and it was recovered by DeMarcus Washington. Back to Grambling in a moment.
Now it's time for this week's Professor Jay coming to you from the future home of the Eddie Robinson Museum here on the campus of Grambling State University. And when this place is complete, folks, it's going to be phenomenal. Over 8,000 square feet of space to pay homage to the man, the myth, the legend, Eddie Robinson. There'll be a theater room. There'll be an interactive play area. There'll be stories galore about Eddie Robinson. Hey, since I'm here, I owe Eddie Robinson so much. I've got to do my part as well. This university here, Grambling, used to have a name that was so long, nobody could pronounce it. It used to be called the North Louisiana Agricultural and Industrial School. Then they changed the name to the Louisiana Negro Normal and Industrial Institute. After getting complaints from the president and the cheerleaders as well, they said, hey, let's shorten the name, and they settled on Grambling. Grambling was named after P.G. Grambling, a sawmill maker here in Louisiana. Did you know that?
Well, I know I did the first game ever played here in this stadium. It was named Eddie Robinson Stadium back in 1983. I also got a chance to do Eddie Robinson's game in Dallas at the Cotton Bowl when they played Prairie View, and he broke Bear Bryant's record. So I've had some history, and it's got good to see this museum coming along.
It's nice. It really is nice. And, you know, that's kind of what Grambling and Southern do. You know, we went to Southern. They got the new field house there. Well, Grambling said, well, we got one better. We're going to have the Eddie Robinson Museum for the coach. And so that's really good. I'm looking forward to that. And, you know, I had the hammer in my hand. Since I'm there, I'm going to help out Coach Rob. He meant a lot to me. I banged a couple nails in there so I can help out the cause as well.
Empty backfield now on second down and 7. Quarterback in trouble. Fumbles the ball. It is a touchdown. Coming up with it for Grambling State University, Derek Johnson, the linebacker, number 59.
You know, if you mess with the bull, sooner or later you're going to get hit by those horns. And Texas Southern was in control. They were playing good football. Then they got sloppy. And once you start getting sloppy, it's hard to get it back together. And Grambling State University just took advantage of the Tigers' own mishaps to gain control of this football game.
And again, Eric Johnson trying to remain perfect in the PAT department this year. And he does. He puts another one through. And just like that, It's a 17-6 ball game. There you look at number 59, the man who recovered the ball, and that is Derek Johnson.
You see where the pressure came from. You see, he's got a nice pocket, but the center just turns and lets him loose, and you cannot do that. Vontrae Sellers, the backup center's in there. You turn him loose on your quarterback. Nelson had nowhere to go. All you can do in that position if you're the quarterback is recognize how close the guy is and cover up the football and get down. Don't allow the turnover plus touchdown to occur. So that's a negative and a negative with the center and the quarterback.
One of those seniors on this Grambling team. Senior day here, last home game before the home crowd for Grambling. The senior out of Monroe, Louisiana, right down the road, Rod Broadway. 70% winning percentage as far as SWAC coaches is concerned.
He's better than Coach Rob.
Oh, he's got a
pretty... I didn't say that. That's a joke.
Well, he's done a good job in the short time he's been here. He's won 24 games, has only lost 10 in his 3 years. He's only the ninth coach in the history of Grambling State University. He was an assistant at UNC. He was an assistant at Florida, Duke, East Carolina, and has done a great job here for this Grambling program.
He's been one of the few coaches I've seen make the transition from major college football to black college football and win on both levels, Division II and the FCS level.
And a pretty good return for Joe Anderson down the left sideline. I believe there's a penalty marker down. Oh, let's see. There's a little skirmish going on in front of the Texas Southern bench on the far sideline. Our referee is going to sort things out. Personal foul, and this is going against Grambling. So we're going to add some yards to that return. Of course, we're talking about Grambling State University, one of the people who we have known for many, many years. I did his games when he played. I think I did.
Yeah, you did. You're old. You're old, Charlie.
Yes, I am. Everson Walls. And it's always great seeing you. And we got a chance to visit with you a little bit at the SWAC MEAC Challenge down in Orlando back in Labor Day weekend. And here you are again. And we're going to talk about some of the things you're doing. And, of course, there's a book out. And I know you want to talk about that. It's first down and 10, Texas Southern. Here's the quarterback. Throws and has a complete. Inside the 40, down to the 35-yard line, and coming up with the reception, number five downfield, that's Haith for Texas Southern University. Jay?
Well, you know, I every time I see Everson Walls, you know I'm a quarterback, defensive back. So we're not that cool.
This is as close as we've been in a long time.
I used to watch Everson when I was a little kid. I used to go out to Thousand Oaks.
He's trying to say you're old.
Yeah, there you go. Passing the buck.
And I like what the players called him. They called him wallpaper.
Well, you remember that.
I
forgot all about that.
Oh, you were the one in Round Springs, obviously, the good work you did with former Coach Springs. But let's talk about you being a Grambling man and the job Rod Broadway's done coming here. Never easy to replace. Not one legend, but two, because you're talking about Eddie Robinson and Doug Williams, and he came in here, and it seems to be making the faithful happy.
You know, this year is not really, I'm sure, what Coach Broadway wants, but I got to tell you, the main thing that he has done, he's continued the tradition. When you start talking about the way Grambling ball players act, the way they carry themselves, the way they are in class and things of that nature. I like what he's doing with these kids. All of them are polite, good young men, and even a few of them came in when I had my book signing a couple of weeks ago. A couple of them bought my book, so I was happy about that. So you know I like these boys.
Last pass complete to Haith. This time Gilbert on the carry goes straight ahead on a third down situation. Now let's see what they do after the third down was not made. Are they going to try to go for it on fourth down? It's going to be a very interesting call for Johnny Cole.
Would you go for it right now, Everson, if you're Johnny Cole here in fourth and two?
Johnny Cole knows the game is getting out of hand right now. He needs to do something to change the momentum back in his favor. I'd go for it.
Well, they're going to go for it. They're 50% in fourth down conversions this season. This is a fourth down and three facing Texas Southern. Ball inside the 30.
Daring them to throw the ball. Heavy man-to-man coverage across the board. Middle of the field, wide open.
Right in the middle, incomplete. Trying to get to tight end Hannah. and it goes incomplete, and they turn it over on down. So Grambling will get the ball back.
Hold on, real quick. Everson, that's why you're up here. You're not coaching. You want to go for it, right?
Well, hey, you just like you said, the middle is wide open. That defensive back was smart. He said, hey, this middle is wide open. I think I better play inside. It only makes good common sense.
Let's talk about the book. It's called Gift for Ron. We know you donated a kidney.
Yes.
To Ron Springs, your teammate who played with the Dallas Cowboys. You, along with Kevin Blackenstone,
yes,
put this book together, and I've got a copy of it already, and I'll tell you, I haven't had a chance to read it. I just got it this week.
Well, the pictures alone inside are very exciting. So if nothing else, it just lets you know the journey that I've taken. I mean, you know, your experience is really what make up the person that you are. And I think this is what this book shows about the things that I was able to do was simply because of not only the way I was raised, but it was because of the great people that I came in contact with. And that's kind of what I wanted to show in here. You can be inspired by many different people, some famous, some not so famous, but still inspiration really has no bounds on where it can come from.
And when you donate a kidney, I mean, it's a body part. I mean, you know, it's not like you're loaning somebody $20. You're giving them a piece of you.
It's not like taking a tooth out or anything.
Exactly. Were there ever any questions in your mind, any second thoughts about it? And did people from the outside come in and say, hey, you may not want to do this?
Hey, man, my mom, my late mom, she just passed away a couple of weeks ago. She was one of the worst critics in regards to me making this decision. But after we did it, there was no one smiling brighter than my mom was in Medical City Hospital in Dallas, Texas, after that surgery was done. She was so proud of me, and that's what I'd always done. I live to be proud, make her proud of me.
Well, that's great. Kiara Thompson on that reception. Well, thank you so much, Everson. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine, man. I'm running 5 miles a day, man. I'm doing pretty well, running the 8-mile race Thanksgiving morning. So I'm trying to get Jay out there, man. Get him on the road.
Right. And when you see Ron, please give him our best.
I will, Charlie. Appreciate
thank you so much,
man.
And thanks for coming by. And the name of the book is A Gift for Ron, talking about Ron Springs. He donated a kidney to his former Dallas Cowboy teammate a few years ago. Everson Walls, thanks for joining us here in the booth.
For those that don't know, I mean, Ron Springs, you know, he went to Ohio State and he played football at the Dallas Cowboys, but he also, his first coaching job, got into coaching was
at Howard University.
At Howard University, right. One of my coaches there. You know, I like to think I played under some great coaches, you know, George Allen and, you know, Willie Brown and then Dennis Green and Bill Parcells. Think about Everson Walls. He played for Eddie Robinson and Tom Landry.
Yeah.
He doesn't know nothing but great coaches.
Good punt. This one. It'll be Grambling going on defense, led by Mr. C.A., Christian Anthony, just a junior, number 90. He's already wreaked a lot of havoc. Let's see how much more he can wreak.
Hi, this is Santoria Black, and the local beat is coming up next right here on ESPNU. Hi, this is Santoria Black of the Grambling Sports Radio Network and ESPN 97.7. Christian Anthony is not only an aggressive football player on the field, but he's also aggressive in his goals and aspirations when he gets done with his football playing days. One day he hopes to be a judge and sit on the bench. That's why we gave him the name Justice. Justice is served every single time that he steps on the football field. Christian Anthony is a guy that is really going to wreak havoc for the other offense. Not only can he step back and he leads the team in interceptions right now, but he's also an individual that will punish the quarterback. Punishment is served, justice is served when Christian Anthony steps on the football field. This is Santoria Black for ESPNU.
5 sacks coming into the ball game for Christian Anthony. 4 interceptions, 2 returned for touchdowns. He's a defensive end, folks.
He's a chief justice. I like that nickname.
Yeah.
Justice.
Back to pass. Quarterback hit as he lets the ball go. And this would had everybody turning the wrong way, including the intended receiver. And that was Anderson. And look at getting some more justice is Anthony getting a hit on the quarterback, Nelson.
You know, right there, and ooh, that kind of hurts right there. Those licks add up.
Here's Santoria Black in the booth right next to us. He's doing the radio broadcast, play-by-play for the Grambling Radio Network. As you look at Christian Anthony and his career, what he's been able to do. Here's Nelson trying to roll away from the pressure. And this one goes in and out of the hands of Haith. Brian Haith, number five, the intended receiver out of Upland, California.
Interesting story. You know, we saw Santori over there in the, doing the radio broadcast. Well, that broadcast got a little Louisiana flavor to it. I'm just giving you a little tease of some things to come up. You just keep in mind the radio broadcast, that's there. But, you know, just like you got Batman and Robin. His Robin, you know, you're Batman and I'm your Robin.
Right.
His Robin, you know, one of my homeboys, literally.
All right.
Fill you in on that a little bit later, Charlie.
Third down conversions tonight, 2 for 6 for Texas Southern. They were 29%, 6 in the SWAC coming into tonight's ball game. Let's see what they do here on this third down and 10. Plenty of time, thrown in the middle. Almost a great catch by the tight end, Jonathan Hanna.
Count the bodies. 1, 2, 3, 4 black jerseys.
And he still almost caught it.
So when the ball was thrown, I said, look out. That means you just got lucky the ball wasn't intercepted. He threw a great pass, but it's just a bad read. The free safety's following the whole time. Right there in the middle of your screen, you saw the free safety, Bruno Foster, just following the quarterback's eyes, and that ball just hit off of the three Tigers. Very fortunate this ball wasn't picked off.
Punting situation, Stefan Solomon, left-footed kicker. Fair catch being called for right at the 29-yard line by Kiara Thompson. Well, let's talk about our 10,000 Facebook fans out there.
Here we go.
And this is from you, Jay. Go ahead.
I want to hear from the people. I've got my rankings that we'll get later on in the broadcast. But what is the toughest road trip in all of black college football? The toughest road trip.
Now, again, are you going to quantify that? What is the criteria?
Toughest place to go win a football game.
All right.
That's what I mean. We'll make it simple. Now, there are other elements. That
I was going to say road trips. You know. I know some tough road trips. I don't have to play, though.
See, and I say this all the time.
Go ahead.
You know, Howard, not a tough road trip. Give you a reason. Even when I was there winning, we had to establish that we had to win, but it wasn't a tough road trip because you're flying into a big airport, you're playing in the media market, and, you know, everybody likes going to D.C. You know, you got relatives. Everybody's got relatives in the D.C. area, so they would come out, and the visitors would have just as many fans as we do. Not a tough road trip. We made it tougher by winning, but there's some places that are some tough road trips.
In more ways than one.
Yes. Another penalty offside. You just can't keep doing that. They're going to hit them hard.
Wide open, Kier Thompson at midfield.
Make them pay. If they're going to keep jumping offside, you make them pay. Remember John Elway made that famous, they used to call it the free play?
Mm-hmm.
You get them to jump offsides, and you whatever you do, you just throw it downfield, because even if they intercept it, you're going to get the ball back, and you keep messing with the Bulls, you're going to get those horns.
22 yards on that pass play. They'll make it 21.
Does that make sense? You know, my daughter says that to me all the time. Daddy, you mess with the Bulls, you get the horns. And right now, I never knew what she meant, but they're getting the horns. You jump offside. Oh, okay, you're going to play with the Bull? You want to go up in the bullpen? Well, let's hit you real quick. Nicely thrown pass, spiral, hit him in stride. Well-coached team there. Good job by Greg Dillon.
First down right shy of midfield for Grambling, leading it by 11 points in the ball game. This time on the ground with the running back, Warren. Warren picks up a couple of yards across midfield, and they'll mark it right at about the 48-yard line. Frank Warren, last year against this Texas Southern team, Warren 113 yards rushing. So far tonight, Mr. Warren with 26 yards on 7 carries and a touchdown.
Much better football team he's facing this year, though, compared to last year. Would you agree?
Oh, no question about it. Here's Warren again with the first down gain, and he's still on his feet inside the 35 to the 34-yard line. And you're talking about that game last year. 33-28 was the score of that contest, and just 101 yards given up by Grambling's defense to Texas Southern, only 38 on the ground.
That's how stingy that Grambling defense was last year. They were one of the best I've seen in some time.
This time on a counter play to the number 27, Walker. This time, number four rusher in the SWAC. Stop played by Gaines, number 29, Jashad Gaines.
Cummins and Gaines on the tackle.
You know, slowly, you see when Texas Southern came in here with all the momentum, they were ready to hit them right away, and Grambling just slowed everything down.
But Grambling's doing the same thing now in this drive. They're going.
Got him.
The home run ball. Defender fell down. Boy, they got lucky on that one because the defensive back fell down and could not recover. That was Zach Gallo, the safety.
Load him asleep right there. They gave him the pump fake, the old out and go, and they fell for it. They took it hook, line, and sinker. And it's a quarterback. Oh, you don't throw it out of bounds. Come on, Greg Dillon. Can't do that, young man.
That's a gift horse. They looked that one straight in the mouth, didn't they?
Yeah, he had time, could have held the ball and done a number of things.
Here's Dillon now under a little pressure. Rolls right, throws back in the middle of the field. Up in the air, finally caught after the rebound by Walker. He batted it to himself. When things go good for you, they go good, don't they?
They do, and that's the frustrating thing. I mean, the pressure gets him out of the pocket. As a quarterback, you're always taught. Once you roll it to your right, don't do what? Don't throw back across your body. But he still wants to throw back across the field. There was a defender there. He got away with it. But you just don't make those mistakes. You got to make sure he's absolutely wide open before you throw that ball. He wasn't absolutely wide open when Dillon released that pass.
That was good for 19 yards. First down and 10. Red zone offense into the end zone. Touchdown. Touchdown, Walker. And Walker with his sixth rushing touchdown of the year. He took it down into the red zone with the reception of 19 yards. Then he takes it into the end zone from 12 yards out.
I'm going to tell you, this Grambling football team is just mentally, they're tough. They're just tough.
31 yards on two plays for Walker and blocked the extra point. First time this year that they missed one. And the punter just needs to lay down. He's the holder. There's a timeout on the field, but it's all Grambling. They're up by 17, 2:34 to go. Here's Mr. Walker into the end zone. Where you go?
Nowhere.
Halftime report.
Back here in Grambling, Louisiana. Here's the college pick'em standings. Now, you and Charles are taking off going at each other, but you watched the guys on the big network today, and they were just as bad as you and Charles.
Yeah, I saw that. You got Mark May and Craig James going at a little bit, but I'm back, Charlie. I'm back.
You've got a pretty substantial lead.
I am ranked in the top 7% in the nation.
24-22 last week, an overall lead of 404.
America's average 15 last week. America got 15.
And you had 24.
Upset.
Even Charles was above the American average.
How'd he get lucky?
Well, he can't defend himself. I'm going to help defend him now.
You don't want to join on that bandwagon, Charlie. You need to stick with me.
On the return is Anderson down the sideline. And Joe Anderson tripped up at about the 40-yard line. Let's revisit our Facebook question. The toughest HBCU road trip all time or current, Jay?
I think it's got to be current, and it's got to be your body of work. You can't just say one period during the 70s. That'd be like me saying, during the 90s, Howard. No, it's got to be your total body of work.
Okay.
Some people are getting what we're getting to, but it's your overall body of work over the years. There's certain road trips I'm talking about where year in, year out, you know it's tough to make.
First down and 10, Texas Southern trailing in the ball game. Here's the quarterback, Nelson, under pressure, and he's going to be sacked. He's going to be dropped back. Christian was the first man to get his hands on him, number 90.
Christian,
and then he got some help from his friends. Kendall Robinson and the rest of the Grambling defense came in there to make sure he didn't get away.
You know, watch the motor. He gets there, and, you know, one thing about Nelson, big, strong kid, 6'5", 240. So you really, 225, you got to bring him down. And that's one there where Christian Anthony got away with a late hit there. Play between the whistles.
Loss of three, second down 13. And this gets him. It's a pass, it's complete. but not much going on as Joe Warren, tailback, sophomore out of Madison High in Houston, made the reception. Carlton Johnson, 59 there defensively for Grambling State. Third down now, third and about nine. Under pressure, it's all over. Another sack. This is a team that came in having been sacked 22 times today. There's the man who got the touchdown, Derek Johnson, on the fumble. He's coming around the corner. Hey, he's hiding around the corner, wasn't he?
Yeah, that's Johnson right there waiting. And, you know, that's how you know that Grambling found a comfort zone in this game. They don't want to blitz the quarterback. They tried to get it done with a four-man rush, but once they feel that, hey, we can get to the quarterback if we blitz him, and they don't have anybody that can run by us right now, double-teaming one wide receiver, they're double-teaming Joe Anderson, and playing man-to-man coverage across the board.
Well, we've got a timeout, and let's answer the Facebook question then.
We're going to give it to you bottom up.
Okay.
We're going to give it to you bottom up.
All right. Go ahead.
Number four, Jackson State. Reason being, I mean, they got the largest black college stadium in the country.
All right.
And they lead in the attendance every year, and they had those errors with the Pages and the Comedies. They can do stuff. Number three, Stratless. Stuff hanging all over the
strike,
place.
Strike again.
And the moment you get in town, you know you're in Tallahassee and it's Florida A&M territory. And, you know, they got the names throughout the years with the Bob Hayes and everybody and Jake Gaither, all that.
Let's go back after this kick. Kier Thompson back to receive the punt, calls for the fair catch, trying to get there, and finally makes it at the 41-yard line. So what's number two?
Number two, I'm proof positive. South Carolina State.
All right.
Now, it's a little easier now because they got field turf, but when they used to have grass, oh, my goodness.
The sequoias growing in the middle of the field.
It would be so high. And Coach Deborah, Buddy Pugh, and you, 9 times out of 10, when you went there, you knew you were coming home with a loss, and they would beat you up. And the number one toughest road trip in black college football, oh, you're seeing it. There's no doubt you're seeing it.
Well, you don't like it. It's not because it's tough to win here. They don't play that many games here. It's just getting here. That's what you don't like.
It's getting here. It's the stadium is below the ground.
You drove from Jackson, Mississippi here. You didn't even want to fly into the closest airport.
It's not easy to get here by plane, train, or automobile.
On the run, they carry the ball with Baptiste going off the right side for Grambling. Go ahead.
This though, Charlie. I mean, the stadium is below ground. The stadium is below ground.
You subterranean.
It's underground.
Yes.
And you're in Grambling with Eddie Robinson.
It's easy to dig down.
And you've got all this, and not easy to get to. And they win. I mean, they win games here. I mean, you know, they're one of the winningest football programs.
Yeah, they haven't lost here in quite a while.
So it's a tough road trip. Tough. I mean, you know, the hotels you're going to stay in is going to be 40 miles away.
No.
Place close to
interception. Dillon's been intercepted, taking it back down the field and going into the end zone for a touchdown. Number six for Texas Southern. And that is Darryl Glasper, the punt return man, defensive back. And that is his first INT of the year. So Dillon picked off only the 10th time this year he's been intercepted. And that's what Coach Broadway was talking about, protecting the football.
You've got to do that. I mean, you were in complete control and command, and then you allow that to happen. You give this team just momentum for the second half. They were dead. They were sitting there, and they were ready to go into the locker room. Now they're ready to go into the locker room with a smile on their face, and, you know, that's just something you just can't do.
So each team has taken advantage of the other team's turnovers by putting points on the board, and that time Darryl Glasper, the senior junior out of Baton Rouge, Louisiana, he just was sitting there waiting for this one, the pick six. He's right in the right
and
place.
Look at the location. I mean, he missed the throw on the screen. That is nothing but a poorly thrown screen pass by the quarterback. The running back was there. He threw it outside. If you don't see him, get rid of it. Look at him. He's going over. It's a screen. You're supposed to look off, find your running back, and hit him. And he missed outside and wide because he was throwing it off his back foot. And I understand as a quarterback, you have to do that so you can get away from the rush. But in that case there, that pick six is all on Greg Dillon.
45 yards on the return. There's Mr. Glasper right there. Number six out of Baton Rouge, Louisiana.
Now they're going to go for two here. If they get it. What's the difference of being down by 9 or being down by 10?
Field goal and an extra point. I mean, it's a touchdown. That's the difference.
What if you don't get it?
Well,
down by 11. Now
we got a flag. Kick the extra point.
Now they kick it. That's what you should do, because if you don't get it, then all of a sudden you need a touchdown, an extra point, and a field goal to do something like that.
They're still going for it, I think. Mm. I think Johnny Cole still wants to go for it. He's telling his quarterback, hey, let's hurry it up here.
I feel your pain, Johnny. I know it's got to be frustrating.
Quarterback rolls right, looking into the end zone, throws it back across his body. Touchdown. Well, the two-point conversion is good. Joe Anderson with it. He has a touchdown reception today, and now he gets the two-point conversion.
And there's a Grambling defender down in the middle of the field, and you know who that is? I think that's Christian Anthony down, but right here, just trying to let Joe Anderson get lost. That's Anderson there going on your right, throwing all the way back against the coverage in the grain, and when you got a big strong arm quarterback, by design, you can set that up for a half roll to the right and throw him back left.
Nigel Copeland was the man that Joe Anderson beat. As you look at Christian Anthony down on the ground, not a pretty sight for this Grambling State team. You know, you talked again earlier, Jay, about the fact they played Oklahoma State. They got beat up. They lost like 6 players in that game. And Anthony, again, let's see what happened to him on that play.
You know, he's going to be coming from your left side on that end, and they're going to let him go. And they took him down. He got by. And the left tackle, he's been giving fits to all day, and that's been Smith. Charles Smith there was able just to get enough helmet on the side there where they didn't call a penalty. And it's going to have Anthony Lippin into the locker room a little bit early in this half.
So Glasper's 45-yard interception return makes it into a two-point conversion. Makes it a 9-point ball game when it looks like it looked there for a while like it was Grambling was just getting ready to put this one to bed, 23-6.
I'm going to tell you, if Christian Anthony does not come back in this game, and he seems like he will, that changes everything, because now you can go to the blocking scheme if you want to. You can give your quarterback Nelson time, and he can find a comfort zone in his own pocket.
Trying to avoid a return and a fair catch call for by Grambling, and they'll get the ball with 20 seconds to go. ESPNU's coverage of men's college basketball action continues on Friday night. Can John Calipari's first season as the coach of the PNU and ESPN UHD Friday at 6:30 p.m. Eastern. Most all-time wins, Division I men's basketball. There you go, Kentucky, right over North Carolina, Kansas.
Who gets to 2000 first?
Who gets to 2000 first? Yeah. Looks like Kentucky might. They're going to take a kneel down, and that's going to be the last play of this first half. So Grambling goes into the locker room. They started off. They were down 6-0, and then they scored 23 unanswered points, but then with 23 seconds to go, it was Texas Southern coming back with an interception, returned 45 yards for a touchdown, and it's a 9-point game at halftime. 23-14 to score, Grambling over Texas Southern. Now, let's go to Lowell Galindo for our Sports Center U update. Christian Anthony, first half, what a half he had, Jay. And there he is. Their quarterback has sacked. There's a fumble.
You know, they had 5 fumbles in the first half, Texas Southern did. They were fortunate enough to recover 3 of them, but they did lose 2. Christian Anthony was getting it done from the very first snap of this football game. He made his presence felt. That's a campus connection for you.
Yeah, no question about it. And Christian Anthony went a little shaken up before halftime. Hopefully he'll be able to return for the second half. And there's your one of the leading candidates for the Buchanan Award that goes to the, he's got to be saying, what in the world is happening here?
Well, he's like, you know, I know his personality, man, y'all are doing too much. Y'all are doing too much.
3 players in the Buchanan watch in addition to Christian Anthony from HBCUs. You've got Jeremy Maddox from Alabama A&M and, of course, Terrell Whitehead from Norfolk State in that hunt right now. Right now, it'll be Texas Southern getting the ball to start the second half. They won the opening toss, but deferred to the second half. And now, good return back up the field by Joe Anderson. So Joe Anderson brings it about back across the 40 to the 41-yard line. So pretty good field position for Texas Southern to start the second half. And they went into the locker room at halftime, Jay, with some momentum after returning that interception. They had given up 23 unanswered points. They returned an interception 45 yards by Glasper with 23 seconds to go before half. So they went in with some momentum.
Yeah, they've got some positive they can use to get back in this football game. And starts off with Arvell Nelson. If he can get that completion percentage higher and they can protect him, that'll help out a lot.
He was sacked three times in the first half. Let's see if they can protect him a little better here in the second half.
I don't see Christian Anthony on the field right now for Grambling. He did limp off going into the half, so that could be big as well.
And there's a run to the right side, and a good run that time for Joe Warren, sophomore out of Houston, Texas. Boy, he's a quick one. He gains about 6 yards on the play. It'll be second down and four.
Look how fast he hits the hole, but when you're a small, quick back, when you get hit, it just stops.
It's like a brick wall you ran into over there,
good
right?
Good open field tackle there by the Tigers.
So second and four after the 6-yard run. This time again, they keep the ball on the ground. That is Texas Southern, and they run right into the heart of the defense for Grambling State. That's Martin Gilbert, the other running back, who against Mississippi Valley a week ago, 91 yards, 2 touchdowns, also had 3 receptions for 27 yards.
And Anthony's back in the game, and they moved him to that left end position rather than the right side where he was doing such a good job. So that's something to watch for as well. But if they can get this drive going for Texas Southern, they can put some more pressure on Grambling to put some more points on the board.
First down is gained on the run. Again, Gilbert on the carry. And they pick up the first down across midfield down to the 48-yard line of Grambling. And there you're looking at Gilbert out of Dallas, Texas, a junior. 57th meeting against Grambling. Actually, Texas Southern won a couple of years ago. I think it was back in 2006, the last time that they last beat Grambling. That was in Houston. Nelson, plenty of time, has it complete for about 4 yards, and that's all for the reception. He got it complete, but not much running room for Joe Anderson, who has a touchdown in the ball game. He caught the first touchdown in the ball game for either team on a 22-yard pass.
Yeah, that was on the fade route, and on this one here, he just sits down. Man-to-man coverage, good job of running away from the defender, and also by the quarterback, Nelson, of putting it on that back left shoulder.
He's got a gun for an arm, doesn't he?
He does, and I think he's really going to be next year. This conference is in trouble because Nelson will have gone through the conference one time, will know what to expect. He'll be more comfortable in the hobo offense. I mean, offensively, they're going to score some points now. Young enough team out there on the offensive side of the ball that got to replace Brian Hayden, but it looks like Joe Anderson ready to step into that role.
Yeah, he's just a sophomore. You got Ricky Dixon coming back. He's a junior. Your tight end is a senior. The other one, Joe Curtin, is this a junior? Here is a pass over the middle, and this is incomplete. That's to the tight end, Jonathan Hanna, the senior out of High Point, North Carolina. And that'll bring up a fourth down.
And that's a couple times we've seen Nelson make that throw. And when you're throwing the running backs and tight ends, you know, I remember Brian Billick, my coach, used to tell me, you want to hit them in the gut with the pass. Don't leave it out there. They have to stretch their arms up. Put it right on that stomach, on that gut, where you're just sticking it in there. He's tried to throw that ball in that quick slant high several occasions, and this very difficult ball to catch. Ball's coming out with a lot of velocity. They just don't have the hands to make that grab. Fourth down going for it, huh?
They are going for it on fourth down.
Pick.
And it's intercepted. We may take this one to the house. Bringing it back for the Tigers of Grambling is T.J. McCord. Touchdown, Grambling. 61 yards.
I'm going to let you explain it, Charlie. You've been doing college football games for a long time, and at that point in the game, 4th and 3, you go for it there, and now you just, all momentum you have is just gone. Quarterback throwing off his back foot, and quarterback, you cannot make that throw, and that's a good job by Cliff Yoshida, the defensive coordinator of Grambling State. You know, when you see a play like that, that means they know the tendencies, and they've studied this team to where they're not being surprised by anything that Texas Southern is doing.
Went after by Harry Johnson. Blocked. That's 2 blocked today. But for T.J. McCord, the 61-yard interception for a touchdown for the senior from 8 Mile, Alabama, right outside of Mobile, went to McGool Tulane High. His first interception of the 2009 season. Back to Grambling in a moment. All this is under new management. You think you want a game that's cool with me? Because I'm going to keep it cool like... 12:15, the time remaining third quarter, 29-14. 15-point advantage for Grambling. Just when Texas Southern looked like they were getting things going, they throw a pick six. T.J. McCord takes it back. 60 yards, official.
From the beginning, we talked about the improvement in the Texas Southern defense. Well, they played a good football game. It's just been that this offense has turned the football over, and Grambling has scored 20 points off of turnovers.
The Home Depot ESPNU College Football Awards coming up Thursday, December 10th at 7 p.m. Eastern, right on the ESPN. Got the Jay Walker Award.
Nah, you don't want that one. Best trash talk, is that what the Jay Walker Award is?
First down and 10 now. Let's see what we have going on now. Now Texas Southern decides they're going to call a timeout. They have the ball at their own 23-yard line. Yeah, we talked about the Buchanan Award and the fact that there's three players from HBCUs involved in that. How about the Peyton Award, named after Walter Peyton?
Fully in Ford, are they still around?
Well, you've got Ford still on there. You've got Curtis Pulley from Florida A&M. Bryant Lee from Southern University. Still in there,
numbers.
Yeah. And, of course, you've got Amonte Edwards from Appalachian State trying to become the first ever player to win it two years. He's never done it. He won it last year, and he's right in the hunt once again.
Nobody's ever won back-to-back?
Never won back-to-back.
I thought Michael Peyton won back-to-back Peyton Awards from Marshall. He didn't win back-to-back Peyton Awards?
No.
Okay. Well, he came in first and finished in second, something like
yeah.
that.
Going back. Here we go, Joe Anderson, and it's incomplete. Yeah, first two-time winner would be Amani Edwards, if he can hold on.
He would deserve it. He's been a special football player ever since he stepped foot on the campus there in Appalachia.
And then, of course, Pat Grace up at Northern Iowa is in the running.
Yeah, they lost two conference games. Yeah. I think that really hurt him.
Pat Devlin from Delaware, they're not having the greatest year. Of course, a big upset last week in the FCS. Richmond, I don't know if you call it an upset, but Villanova beats Richmond in Richmond, the defending FCS champs.
Where'd you go to school, Charlie?
Hey, do I have to say?
You know,
it wasn't America's Black College.
Yeah, you know you were cheering for that team out of Philadelphia.
First down and 10. Option play to the right side. Here's Gilbert trying to turn the corner. Still on his feet and out across the 40 to about the 45-yard line. Finally brought down.
I always like when you run an option and the quarterback knows who the option off of. Clear who they're leaving unblocked. In that case there, it was Kendall Robinson, the defensive end. Quarterback comes down the line, makes the pitch off of him. Big play. And this is one advantage you have when you got that hobo offense. Even though you're down by 15 points, you're never out of it because you got plenty of time to get back into it.
That was a 16-yard run that time by Gilbert. Here's a little swing pass out of the backfield. And across midfield, they gain about 8 on that one. On the pass play from the quarterback, Ricky Dixon, the junior out of St. John's High, East St. John High in New Orleans.
I just saw something there. You know, we talk about having a strong arm quarterback, and that's what Nelson is, but he throws a very heavy ball. I mean, even when he's throwing a 5-yard pass with some touch, it's still heavy.
Yeah, it's like a sinker, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Here again, Gilbert into the secondary, has the first down to the 40. So they're picking up some yards on the ground right now. This Texas Southern team did not have a good running game in the first half. In fact, came in with less than 700 yards on the season rushing.
Yeah, you know, and anytime you can pick up some yards running the football, that's a plus. And it'll only help when you've got a quarterback out there that can throw strikes like Nelson has the potential to do.
But you know what's so interesting about that, Jay? About 85, 88 yards a game rushing, they still scored half of their touchdowns on the ground. 10 touchdowns rushing, 10 touchdowns passing.
Yeah, that happens. I mean, my senior year at Howard, Rupert Grant had 20 touchdowns.
Here's Gilbert on the carry on first down, a gain of 1. And that is it before he is brought down by Kendall Robinson, number 91.
And that was one of those times where I'm sure they would love to try and figure out a way to get a one-on-one matchup with Joe Anderson against the Grambling secondary, but what Grambling's doing right now is they're giving Anderson help. You see Anderson here on the bottom of your screen on the right. You see one guy in his face, but the safety is waiting for him 12 yards deep. So
he's shadowing him.
So you got to go on the other side of the field.
Quarterback in trouble. Decides he's going to sidestep a man still on his feet and has a first down, down to the 30. So good feet by the quarterback.
Did you see the box out by Vontrae Long, by Vontrae Sellers? Take a look, number 74. Once the quarterback leaves, he's like, who am I going to block? Now you see him on the left side. Look at him. He's going to screen the guy. He's backing him into the low post.
Yeah, Mr. Sellers.
And that's a lot of person to be backing somebody into the low post.
Junior from Dillon, South Carolina. Vontrae, a junior. 6'2", 300-pound center. This team, Texas Southern, was picked to finish fourth in the Western Division in the preseason polls of the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Grambling picked to finish first. And right now, a battle between Grambling and this team here, when you look at the standings. Nelson standing in there. He's going to take off, trying to get to the outside. He's going to turn the corner. He's going to outrun anybody on that side. I believe that was Crawford that he outrun over there, Maurice Crawford. Number 96.
Yeah, you know, Crawford just kind of gave up. Like, I can't catch that. So, you know, you'll see him there on the outside. As he's running, he's going to go sideways. And he says, well, let me buy myself a little bit more time. And he does that. And mobile quarterbacks, that's what they do to you.
Now another timeout call, this time by Grambling. We're talking about the Western Division. Prairie View in top spot. Texas Southern is all alone in second at 3-1, while Grambling battling Arkansas Pine Bluff for the next couple spots. And when you're talking about big games coming up this weekend, Jay and the SWAC, you know, Prairie View and Alcorn, Prairie View is at Alcorn. Prairie View can clinch their first ever spot in the SWAC championship game with a win. They last won a SWAC title way back in 1964. And they're on a five-game winning streak. Alcorn has lost their last two, and a win would keep their Eastern Division hopes alive. They still have a game left against Jackson State. Jackson State's in the driver's seat as far as the East is concerned.
They got a
right
big
now.
One this weekend, though. It's Jackson State and Alabama A&M.
Yeah, they're traveling to Huntsville for that one. They, you know, they control their own destiny. They're looking for their third straight win and to take another step toward their third straight appearance in the SWAC championship game. Alabama A&M, though, can force a tie for the top spot in the East with a win. So it's going to be very interesting. Like I said, topsy-turvy season as far as the SWAC is concerned. A lot of people say, who would have thunk it, huh?
Yeah, and I'll tell you, this is a measuring stick game for Texas Southern, and I'll tell you why right after this play on the incomplete pass by Nelson, because when you look at Texas Southern, you know, they're in second place, they're doing well, and they're the state champions of Mississippi. And if you're going to compete, you got to go in right there, wipe out Mississippi. Texas Southern, yeah. They knocked off the Mississippi schools. They beat Jackson, they beat Alcorn, and they beat Valley. Now, the key is, what are you going to do with Louisiana? You know, they got Grambling now, and they got Southern coming up next.
After the Bayou Classic, Southern plays Texas Southern in Houston.
So that's the key there. So that's the measuring stick of where your program really is.
Third down now, quarterback in trouble. Trying to get out of there, and he is sacked. Brought down finally. I'll tell you, he really kept his legs moving there, but a lot of black jerseys around that. The quarterback.
Yeah, the effort here, you see them, they brought five with the pressure, and they were able to get there. Nelson wasn't going down without a fight.
No, he did go down without a fight.
But that's just tough. And, you know, when you get down there that close to the end zone, you can't take sacks. You got to get rid of the football so you can at least make a field goal attempt. And considering that they are 1-for-3 in field goals between the distance of 40 and 49 yards, you can see why Coach Cole is going for it on fourth down.
0-for-3 on fourth downs tonight. Quarterback's going to take off and run. Has room. First down. Still on his feet at the 5. Touchdown, Texas Southern.
The hobo.
31 yards.
Where'd they find this kid from? I mean, he
transferred from Fort Scott, Kansas Community College.
Strong arm, and look at the feet. I mean, to be 6'5" tall, he's got nifty feet. I mean, look at this. Look at the cut here. The ability to run, protect the football, but the cut there, making it look smooth.
On a fourth down play, he takes it in, 31 yards for the touchdown, and now they're going to go for the two-point conversion. Try to make it a 7-point game. Throws wide open. They get it to the tight end, Hannah. And now there's...
That's an ineligible.
They had an ineligible man downfield. Who was it?
I think it was the one that caught the touchdown. Did he report?
He was a tight end, wasn't he?
I don't think he was lined up on that tight end. I think they did an offensive overload.
Number 88, right? Hannah is the tight end.
I mean, whatever the case may be, you still can't have that. That's been the story. You know, we talked about Texas Southern. They had 133 yards worth of penalties in the first half. Now you got an opportunity to get right back in this football game. Your offense scored. You can make it a one-score possession, and you get a penalty like that, which is another mental error.
With 8:04 left in the third quarter.
4 seconds on the clock. Now they're either going to have to use a timeout or make it even further for them to go. And once the penalty was called, you know, they're going to take a delay of game right now.
Maybe they want to have a long pass.
Yeah, okay. So you sell that to somebody else, Mr. Neal.
It's going to be a ball spotted at the 13-yard line.
Why not go with the extra point? The kicker must not have any ability at all, because, you know.
Well, that's not necessarily true, Jay.
If you're going to be down by nine.
I mean, he's missed five field goals. He's hit a 44-yarder this year. He's had one block. You know, he's missed three of his last four now. We'll put it that way. This one's incomplete. Joe Anderson, the intended receiver, quarterback under pressure, and they failed to get it.
And you're down by two scores.
It's Charles Smith. It's a little slow getting up. 29-20 is our score. 8:04 to go. Texas Southern with a pretty good drive that time. 71 yards. And they pull to within nine. All this is under new management. You think you want a game that's cool with me? Because I'm going to keep it cool like 2 degrees. Because what's yours ain't got to do with me. And none of these other cats could fool me. No.
On the corner of Main and Lake is where my family had their roots. My cousin Goody still has this house here that she owns and comes down every year, and we're coming down here for the family reunion next year. So that's a bag full of shells, and you can do it in 30 minutes. And look at all these pecans. There's a post office in Colfax. That's a good thing. At least I can get my mail delivered to me if I need to. Some of the last remnants my family has here in Colfax, Louisiana. We've got, I think it's 38 acres of land back here behind me. That's the fence to get in there. Right now, he's got some wild horses on there. There's a guy that grooms horses in. So we got pecans and we got horses. And we're going to get some food here in Colfax, Louisiana. All right.
I know you're totally lost. You're a city boy, L.A., D.C., still in the D.C. area.
Everybody from L.A.
And now you
is daddy, from someplace else.
And now you're Colfax. Yeah, but you're not.
My daddy's
your
from daddy, Colfax, Louisiana.
Your daddy. But you don't know anything about Colfax and the
it's
country.
It's home of the Louisiana pecan. So you call it a pecan. It's the pecan festival. 2,200 people in Colfax. They get 75,000 people that go to Colfax for the pecan festival.
And how many times have you been there for the festival?
It's during football season.
Why are you stuttering?
It was just last week.
At the 12-yard line, on the return, Grambling, a man breaking out of there, getting some running room. That's Dominique Bell. Bell across the 30, inside the 30 to the 28-yard line. Dominique Bell, his longest return this year, was 39 yards. This one was good for 59.
And this was an effort. They just didn't wrap him up. You've got Bell in the wedge. Make that tackle there. You're diving, leaving your feet. What are you going to do? That's tackling a guy up high, and you'll see him there. It becomes a foot race. Good effort there by the Texas Southern defender to not give up. But if you're going to beat a team on the road, get a road victory, you got to beat them on offense, defense, and special teams. And special teams is letting down Texas Southern again.
They were trying to get into the end zone that time on the kickoff return. Grambling had not scored a touchdown on the kickoff return this year. They had scored twice on punt returns. First down and 10 for the Tigers. Warren to the left side. Nothing doing there. Post the white jerseys there to meet him back to the line of scrimmage, and that'll be it. Robert Joseph there defensively, number 7. SWAC newcomer of the week against Rutgers earlier this season. 13 tackles, 9 assists. And talk about this Grambling team starting off the season. We saw them early on, their first game against South Carolina State in the SWAC-MEAC Challenge, which they lost that one 34-31. He actually had more yards than the Bulldogs of South Carolina State, but committed 4 turnovers. Dylan, a pretty good game that day, 2 touchdowns passing, over 260 yards in the air.
But the turnovers ended up getting to him. That's South Carolina State, yeah, losing to them was respectable. I mean, they're ranked number 8 right now in all of SES. So that lets you know the type of talent they have when you can play with a football team and hurt yourself.
Pressure on the quarterback. Dylan lets it fly into the end zone. Incomplete. He dropped it. He had it. That was Warren out there in front. Let's make that the tight end. That's not Warren. That's 83 on the reception for Grambling. Van Phillips out of Irondale, Alabama, the sophomore who had 14 catches coming into the ball game and 3 touchdown receptions, but just couldn't pull the handle in that time.
Yeah, left his feet. Just run through the ball. Run through the ball, and you can make that catch.
Third down and 11. Blitz coming. They pick it up pretty good, and they have it complete. And not much running room after the completion. On the reception for Grambling, Bakari Maxwell, number 9.
And that's what you want there. If they're going to bring a blitzing defense, you know they're playing man-to-man coverage. The weakness in man-to-man coverage is crossing routes. If you can get a guy, hit him in stride, he can have the ability to run away from somebody.
40-yard field goal coming for Ari Johnson. He's had his couple of extra points blocked tonight. He's 15 of 20 in field goals this year. 47 is his longest. This one is good. So he's hit 2 field goals tonight. Ari Thomas, Johnson, the freshman from California. And
Charlie, I know you're a city slicker. You know, I know you don't know anything about this. But see, here's the difference. See, you got the meaty pecan.
Go ahead.
That's the meaty one there.
All right,
that's top dollar. Then you got the little skinny one. Like, this is like this. I'm the meaty one, and this is you right here. You know, you got the small one here. But I will tell you, I forgot how good these things are. Pecans. So we got a pecan farm down there. You're welcome to come out anytime. Little city slicker like yourself. 80 miles from Grambling.
So we know how hard it is to get to Grambling. It's
even harder. It's even harder to get the call back. It's even harder, but it's a good time. That lets you know what the SWAC is all about. You know, we always talk about the SWAC is about tradition and keeping it in the family. And Colfax, I know you can't believe this, but Colfax is not a football town. It's a basketball town.
Okay.
And so when you talk to the people here in Grambling, they say, oh, Colfax, oh, you got some basketball players there, and we do. And that lets you know I can ball, Charlie.
What direction from
south
here?
South.
So which way do you get on 20?
No, that would be easy to get to. You got to take Highway 167 from Grambling to get down there. That would be easy. But it's good. You know, saw my graveyard where my grandparents were buried, and then I've got my great-grandparents that were buried there as well. And it always feels good to come home, no matter where home may be for everybody, and just feel for the troops over there with this Veteran Day weekend. Can't wait till they all get home as well, too.
ESPNU's coverage of college football continues Friday. Mac Style, the Owls of Temple take on the Zips of Akron. College football primetime on ESPNU and ESPNU HD Friday at 8:30 p.m. Eastern. For more info, log on ESPNU.com. Owls 7-2, 5-0 in the Mid-American Conference. Bernard Pierce, pretty good running back.
Just a baby.
78 yards and 3
touchdowns.
He's just
a baby. He's a freshman.
Out. Yeah.
He's a freshman. Just a baby.
Look at him. 1,200 yards rushing. Maybe the only 1,000-yard rusher in the MAC right now. I don't know if that's a fact, but very close. Done a great job for the Owls this year. And as you see, the quarterback Nelson on the carry that time. So Grambling has just increased their lead to 32-20. They have a 12-point lead over this Texas Southern team who will not go away.
No, they won't.
Harry Johnson with a pair of field goals tonight, a 37-yard and a 40-yarder. And now here's Texas Southern with a 2nd down and 1. And they should have enough for the first down.
You know, and when the Texas Southern offense is rolling, you see right now, after the play is over, they're standing. They want to get that ball snapping. When they're winding the clock, that ball will be snapping. 25 seconds to go, which is a lot of time in today's college football because most offenses are snapping the ball with 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Texas Southern's getting that ball snapped when the play clock is in the 20s.
First down and 10 now, Texas Southern. False start. Another penalty, number 11. And it's on the left tackle, the preseason all-conference selection, Charles Smith.
He's, look at that picture there. Who's that?
That's
Melvin Mr. Shades
Spears.
Back.
Melvin Spears, who coaches the running backs, who used to be the head coach here at Grambling. He's the running backs coach over at Texas Southern. First down, 15 now. And this one is complete for about 10 yards. And it's Dixon on the reception.
Foster on the tackle.
Ricky Dixon on the reception. Bruno Foster, the strong safety, had to make the stop, number 3. But a 10-yard gain, it'll be second down and 5.
Yeah, that was a good grab by Ricky Dixon. We talked about the heavy ball that Nelson throws, and that ball was thrown high, but he had the strong hands in order to snatch that ball out of the air and come down with the reception.
Here's a little quick pitch to the left side.
Joseph Warren with the reception from Nelson.
Warren with the reception. There is Melvin Spears, who we used to be a head coach here, Foster used to roam the near sideline for Grambling.
This is his first time in 4 years, he said, coming back to Grambling. Didn't realize it'd been that long.
Yeah, because they didn't. Last year when they got the job there, they played in Houston. Here we go into the secondary and look down the field. There he goes, number 21. That's Joe Warren. He can pick him up and lay him down.
And you can tell that Grambling defense was getting antsy. They started bringing more pressure, trying to bring pressure. Look at the linebackers coming. They're blitzing. That's a run blitz. Opened up and look at the footwork by Warren. Getting to the outside, a little quick thing.
32 yards. For Mr. Warren, his longest run of the season. And the previous long was 22.
And look at that. They're on the gas pedal. Ball with 25 seconds left. They're ready to snap it right now. They waste no time getting to the line of scrimmage and getting plays called.
In the red zone, there's the quarterback, Nelson, taking off. And then he throws for a touchdown.
Didn't take long, did it?
No, he didn't take long, and he gets it to Joe Anderson. Anderson with his second touchdown reception of the night. I thought he was going to take off and run it, and he found Anderson down there. Watch it.
And that's what happens when you cave down the whole defensive line. Your quarterback can decide whether I'll run or pass. Very hard to defend a wide receiver when you got a quarterback running right behind him. The moment you take that half a second to take a look, then they're behind you.
They're going to go for the extra point this time. And it'll be Robert Hirsch on for the point after. To make it a 5-point ball game.
Wow.
And we still have 3.5 to go in the third quarter. This kick is good. 32-27. We thought that Texas Southern was dead. They have arisen. We'll be back to Grambling in a moment. So what you say, can I handle it? All this is under new management. You think you want a game that's cool with me? Because I'm going to keep it cool. Rod Broadway not happy, thinking that quarterback Arvell Nelson had stepped across the line when he threw the ball. And let's look at it. He was definitely behind the line of scrimmage. The ball is at the 10-yard line, Jay.
Yeah, it's right there. Because of the deep drop, and he's a long strider, but you'll see as he gets close, all you have to do is have a part of your body behind that line of scrimmage, and you're considered behind the line of scrimmage. In that case, he's clearly behind the line of scrimmage. I understand you're upset and disappointed, but that's a legal play. The Stripes got it right.
Rod Broadway in his third year here, ninth coach. Ask him who he likes as far as coaches. He says he's a fan of Bob Stoops. He's also a fan of Joe Taylor and Buddy Pugh. A couple of MEAC coaches. Short kick. A big day of football. Techno has lost 3 straight. Trying to rebound from that. Grambling with the ball. They lead it by 5, 32-27. Just to recap it, just in case you joined us, Texas Southern struck first led 6-0, and then they gave up 23 unanswered points. Or, you know, it was 23-6 there, and then they finally scored just with 23 seconds to go in the half to make it a 9-point game at the half. Then Grambling came out and went up ahead 29-14 and then 29-20. Now it's 32-27. Long pass down the sideline. Incomplete. Good battle down there defensively between Kadarian Williams and Bakari Maxwell, the intended receiver, number 9.
I'm a little surprised that Coach Broadway and the Grambling staff are willing to get into a high-scoring competition with Texas Southern. You know, if we called it a shootout, we would say Texas Southern has just as many bullets as Grambling does on the offensive side. And Grambling showing, hey, we're willing to air this thing out too.
Well, you know, one of the things that Broadway knows as the quarterback is sacked for the second time tonight, that is Dillon, is that they scored 42 points, that is Grambling, a week ago against Arkansas Pine Bluff and still lost the game.
Yeah, so you should know that, you know, you need to go to a ball control offense to start running the football, and you'll see there just nowhere to go. We looked at the 1-2, and the me was a, oh no, they're getting ready to sack me.
So, Grambling will punt it on fourth down.
Does that surprise you? I mean, to see Grambling willing to go no huddle and continue to trade passes with this Texas Southern offense?
Well, especially since they have a good running attack.
Yeah, two great running backs. But maybe we're up here, we're not giving credit to the defensive line of Texas Southern. They're doing a good job in neutralizing them and forcing Grambling to go to an alternative game plan.
Left-footed punter from the 18-yard line. Flags are going to go down. We're going to get an illegal block in the back as the return is made by Richard Samuel. It was a clear penalty. I mean, the man in the moon saw that one.
I mean, there are two flags down there, so every official over there saw that one. Block in the back, I mean, that's another one of those mental errors, I think. You know, you determine whether or not you're going to hit a guy in the back before you do it.
Well, you know, we talk about the SWAC Championship coming up December 12th in Birmingham. It'll be the 11th edition of the SWAC Championship. And, of course, Prairie View there can clinch the Western Division and a berth for their first ever berth in the SWAC Championship and a chance to win for the first time since 1964. Jackson State, if they win, they can win the East with the wins over Alabama A&M this Saturday and a loss by Alcorn State. They're playing Prairie View. Here's a pass down the middle of the field, and it's caught. And that's Randall Newsom coming out of the backfield, number 34, sophomore out of Fort Worth, Texas. Southwest Christian, only his second reception of the year, good for 43 yards.
This is razzle dazzle, but it fools nobody. I mean, there's a safety right there to make the play. They just run into each other. Normally, when you take that type of drop back and play action, you're trying to trick the safety. They didn't fall for it, but he just had a strong enough arm to squeeze it in there.
Quarterback runs this time. Nelson holds onto the football after about a 9-yard gain. They'll mark it for 8. Right inside the 40. This Texas Southern team hasn't given up, I'll tell you. You know, you've got to be worried if you're Grambling, and it's still another 16 minutes to go in this ball game.
And their foot is on the gas pedal, and they are not letting up. They're getting up to the line of scrimmage, trying to get plays called. You know, this hobo offense strikes quickly.
They're going to give him only 7 yards on that run.
Only 7 yards. That's good on first down, getting 7 yards, Charlie.
So you're second and short. One back there. Here's a flip to Haith. Near side, Haith down to 30 and has a first down.
When we talk about a team being coached by Johnny Cole, you know, having big offensive play potential, I mean, that's no surprise. I mean, everywhere he's gone, the offenses have done fantastic. I mean,
he was an assistant at Alabama State to his brother, LC, who happens to be in attendance here tonight. He's the head coach over at Miles College in Birmingham.
And go back to when he was at Tennessee State.
Not Miles.
Stillman
College down in Tuscaloosa.
But then when Cole was at Tennessee State, Leon Murray, you know, had all types of offensive records there. Then you know about Darnell Kennedy when he was at Alabama State, as you alluded to. So it should be no big surprise to those people that have followed the career of Johnny Cole that he has nothing else. He's going to have an offense.
No question.
And once they start working on the defensive side of the ball, wouldn't it be something? I mean, how things can change. It used to be that Texas used to be the easy part of the Western bracket SWAC, and now Texas could have the two best teams in the SWAC.
Well, that's going to be the end of the third quarter here. Johnny Cole's team is trying to make it a big one, trying to gain the lead. They are down by five as we start the final fourth quarter. Let's turn it up obnoxious. Showtime and the pressure don't stop. It's time for you to show and prove, and trust me, I will not. And there has been fireworks here tonight between the two teams. 59 points up on the board. Texas Southern with the ball, threatening to put some more up on the board. Charlie Neal along with Jay Walker. Glad you could join us for our Thursday night primetime college football SWAC style from Grambling State University in Grambling, Louisiana. They're hosting Texas Southern in the white jerseys. They have the ball. Here's a pass to Haith from the quarterback, and Haith looks like he has enough for the first down, or is very close to it, maybe a yard or two shy. Through three quarters, here's what it's looked like. Texas Southern has dominated the stats. They've shot themselves in the foot with penalties and three turnovers that have led to Grambling's points, and there's the quarterback on the keeper, enough for the first down for the quarterback, Arvell Nelson.
Yeah, that's something that, you know, in spite of themselves, they're still in this football game. And one thing that's good news for Texas Southern, regardless of what you've done previous, the turnovers and the fumbles and all the other stuff, throw that out the window. You're in a position to take the lead in the fourth quarter on the road, which is all any coach can ask for, and they're clicking on all cylinders right now.
They certainly are, Jay, and they have two games left. They play Arkansas Pine Bluff at home and at Southern. So both of their remaining games are in Houston. First down and 10.
And that was a misprint. I mean, Texas Southern has 12 penalties for 166 yards. We showed 74.
Yeah, I don't know if it's that many yards, but I know they have that many penalties. And there's Gilbert.
That's a touchdown.
Touchdown, Texas Southern. And he takes that one in from 17 yards out. Gilbert with the touchdown. And that is his fourth touchdown of the season.
Down block. Once that thing is sealed, you're going to see a good running back with balance. It's not going to let the first man bring him down. And if the first guy is trying to make the tackle 10 yards downfield, you can cancel Christmas. It's over. Touchdown. Good job by Martin Gilbert. The resiliency of these boys from down there in Texas.
What made it more impressive, that was an 88-yard drive, Jay. Seven plays, 2:37 off the clock. They're going for two, and they've been pretty successful. They're one up by 1 point, trying to make it a three-point ball game. They lead it 33-32.
I agree, we're going for two right now. You'll get yourself a three-point lead compared to a two-point lead.
From the shotgun, Nelson is going to work. Looking to his right, in trouble, throws it into the end zone, and it's incomplete. Trying to get it to Ricky Dixon, but it's still a one-point lead. Texas Southern regains the lead. Remember, at one point, they were down 23-6 at one point in this ball game, but now have regained the lead. As we look at our Sheridan top 10 poll, South Carolina State on top 8-1, Prairie View right behind them, and FAMU holds up third place. Tuskegee has done a pretty good job. We'll see them right here on Thursday, Thanksgiving Day, against Alabama State in an interconference matchup. Of course, Southern is in fifth place. Shaw is in sixth. Grambling, seventh. Albany State has kind of dropped a couple games.
Yeah.
Here in South Carolina State's remaining schedule. This is the team to watch. They play Morgan on Saturday. They play North Carolina A&T November 21st.
Yeah, and, you know, with the MEAC, all but the clinch for them. They're, you know, they'll go in the postseason. They'll get the automatic bid. They got to be careful when they play North Carolina A&T. You know, A&T would love nothing more than to knock them off, you know, as they're going into the playoffs, if they're able to make it. When you look at the top 10, only problem I've got with that top 10, and we'll take a look at that after this kickoff, but small problem there in the top 10. Oh, this is going to hit the ground. Look at this. Look at this. Look at that.
They recovered that.
That's like an onside kick.
Almost an onside kick for Texas
Southern. Was perfectly done.
Yes, it was. Carl Chisholm out of Washington, D.C.
Look at the distance. This is the perfect distance. That ball goes about 18, 19 yards. If you can have that ball land 18, 19 yards, that's such a crease because the up man has to be within 10 yards. And once they're within 10 yards, it's hard for them to run backwards 8, 9 yards. And there's that little crease there. And that was perfectly placed by Robert Hirsch, the kicker.
Yeah.
I'm going to give the kicker some props, Carl. Well, they don't trust him to go for field goal, but they trust him on some pooch kicks.
And a good job and alertness on the part of Carl Chisholm to bring it down. First and 10 at the 42 of Grambling. 14:02 left in the ball game.
Razzle dazzle.
Here's Anderson back to the quarterback. They lose big yards.
And
15 yards they lose on that.
And when you go back and look at it, Joe Anderson, the wide receiver, saw it coming. And he was.
That's why he gave it back.
He said, well, should I pitch it or should I hold it? And what you tell him is if there's a blitz coming or something like that, you just hold it and take a small side. But watch when he gets it. He's going to see the guy that's in position to hit him. He's got it. He's looking, should I? Well, maybe not. And he was going to go try and block him, but it was too late. Too much momentum from the defense, and they did a good job of the defensive end staying at home. I mean, your defense can become such a good defense if you can just teach your defensive end to stay at home. I promise you, good things will happen.
Officially, it's a loss of 14 on the play, so it's second down and 24. Kendall Robinson putting pressure on the quarterback, who throws it out of the outstretched hands of Dominique Bell, the cornerback who was defending downfield, number 20 there.
That's one there that was very dangerous, throwing that ball up there for grabs. Don't want to make it too tough. And, you know, the one thing about Nelson, I mean, look at this. You talk about arm strength. Look at which way his body's going when he throws this ball. I mean, there's nothing going forward with that pass except the ball. All arm and flung it downfield 45, 50 yards off the back leg with no step into it at all.
Used to be able to do that. Used to.
Try not to, though. If you got proper footwork, you always step into your throws.
It is third and 24. That could have been picked.
It is picked.
And again, there's T.J. McCord, his second interception of the day. He had one earlier that he ran back for a touchdown. T.J. hadn't had any interceptions before tonight. He had a 60-yarder. He returned for a touchdown as we started the third quarter. He picks up another one there. Every turnover has resulted in points for Grambling. Let's see if they can capitalize this time.
Get out of my way. It's crunch time.
When credit card companies are charging high interest.
So what year did they come into the SWAC?
Well, the school was established in 1947.
Okay. Go ahead.
No need to say anything else.
All right.
What year did they come into SWAC, Charles?
Here's Warren off the right side. Warren gets the first down, picks up about 12 yards. On that particular play, there's a team that won the Black National Championship in 1952. That was before they came into the SWAC. And here we go again. Quick plays by Grambling, still on his feet, but flags are down as they continue to run. They joined the SWAC in 1956.
Okay.
They came into this came into existence in 47, won a Black National Championship in 52, joined the SWAC in 56. Holding against Grambling is the play.
That's why, you know, I don't call myself the doctor, I'm the professor. You know, you're the doctor of black college football and football. You're the doctor. I'll just be the professor.
All right.
But it is the youngest institution in the SWAC. I mean, and you can think about today's world, 1947 is a young institution.
That's not that old.
Not at all.
62 years. Of course, Michael Strahan is a product of Texas Southern University. All SWAC in 91 and 92. And there's the quarterback, Dylan, keeping the ball. And he gets it out to about the 40, down to about the 44-yard line. He played for Walter Highsmith there.
Yep.
In fact, your old coach, Steve Wilson, coached. He was the predecessor to Johnny Cole coming in. Didn't have a successful year, 4 years at Texas Southern, but was there Of course, Rod Page, the former Secretary of Education under Bill Clinton, was a coach at Texas Southern. A lot of people may not remember or know that. I knew you knew that.
Yes, I did.
This one's incomplete. A little bit too big. The far sideline over there.
This is something that with the Grambling offense and still, you know, with being a one-point game, they're still trying to go, you know, point for point, muscle for muscle with the big play offense. And Grambling, you know, that's just not who they are. Or at least it hasn't been when they had championship seasons. And now they're trying to throw the football. And, you know, Grambling, I'm used to a horizontal passing attack. You know, the vertical pack is something new. They normally extend the field sideways before they go up and down.
Third down now. Here's Dillon with some time, trying to buy some more time with his feet now. Under a little pressure, lets it go out of bounds. He was being chased, and the pressure was on. John Cole was the man. There he is, number 53, senior out of Phoenix, Arizona's Chaparral High, was putting the chase on the quarterback, Greg Dillon. And that's going to bring on the punter. That is Fabian Carter, the left footer. Nobody back to receive this punt for Texas Southern. So are they coming for a block? There's nobody back to receive it. They drop off. And it's going to take a bounce right inside the 20 and die at about the 13-yard line. Don't forget December 10th. The Home Depot ESPNU College Football Awards. A lot of people. Who do you like for the Biletnikoff?
I like A.J. Green at Georgia, but the numbers haven't been there. Then, you know, the wide receiver at, you know, at South Carolina is fantastic as well. And
you already talked about, how about the Outland Trophy?
For the Outland Trophy, so you got to think about what all these trophies are for. The Outland Trophy is for the best interior defensive lineman, right? Christian Anthony. Oh, he's up for the Buckby candidate.
Hey, I think he'd like it. He'd take that too. It is first down and 10, Texas Southern. The ball at their own 17, 18-yard line. Keeping it on the ground once again. And Gilbert now, who had the last touchdown, not able to get around the corner as Christian Anthony, as you just mentioned, was there to make the stop. We're in Grambling, Louisiana for this college football primetime telecast at Eddie Robinson Stadium. Texas Southern against Grambling in a SWAC matchup. I'm Charlie Neal, along with my partner Jay Walker, and glad you could join us for this one. In a one-point ball game, 33-32, Texas Southern, which was trailing 23-6 at one time, is now taking a one-point lead, and they just sacked the quarterback for the fifth time tonight.
They got to him. They haven't been able to do that much here in this second half, but just like any team that hangs their hat on defense year in and year out, when the defense needs to step up and make a big play, looks like the Tigers are doing it. Just to show you, I got a football IQ for the Outland Award. It'll come down to two people, McCoy from Oklahoma, and he's banged up, and Mount Cody. I think that Mount Cody with the two blocks, people are going to remember that. Voters will remember that.
He's something. He is a mountain, isn't he?
Yeah, he's a load of a man.
And, of course, you already voted for your coach of the year, Cincinnati.
If they went out.
Nelson stands in there, throws. Whipped again.
What an interception.
This time it's Exuma on the return. Exuma down inside the 20, down to about the 18-yard line, but they'll mark it at the 15. Exuma, the middle linebacker, with his first
one hand,
interception,
Charlie,
of the year.
Look at him. You see him there. He's going in the drop chase, and right when he's supposed to drop off the guy, he goes up and grabs it with one hand out of the air. Look at this. Look at the hops, the extension. Pulls it in.
Fifth turnover of the night for Texas Southern, the third interception that they've thrown tonight.
Man, and anytime you see a linebacker, a middle linebacker with the towel on the side, that means he was a running back in high school. Most middle linebackers don't worry about style points and looking pretty, but Exuma, you can tell with the hands and the towel location, he was a running back in high school, I'm pretty sure.
So Grambling, just their second offensive possession, I think, the second half as Dillon is brought down.
Now, if you're Grambling right now at this point in the ball game, you're saying, eat up a little clock. Touchdown would be great, touchdown would be great, but a field goal would be nice
Harry
as well.
Harry Johnson's done a pretty good job for them. He's kicked two field goals tonight so far. He's kicked one from 37 yards out and another one from 40 yards out. So well within his range right now with the ball resting at about 17.
Too. Take the deep shot. You've got the deep shot here. They're daring you to.
Here they come. And they got him.
Don't take the sack. Oh, he lost even more yardage.
They got him.
Wow.
Game. And there's Fulgham, DeJuan Fulgham, the middle linebacker from Texas Southern out of Killeen, Texas, from Harker Heights High.
You know, look at that. Once you see that pressure's coming, you got to think the last thing you can do is start running backwards. Good job of filling the gaps there by the Texas Southern defense, and there was really no place for Greg Dillon to run with the football, but you can't run backwards. It's a field position game, and every yard you lose, the chances of success on the field goal attempt, if you have to try one, and you probably will, looking at third 20, go down.
It would be a 42-yarder if they fail to pick up the first down here from here. If they had to go back to the original line of scrimmage. He steps up, throws,
got a guy.
And wide open, and touchdown. Touchdown is Ward. On the reception, Frank Ward. That's his third touchdown reception of the year.
If you let a team convert third 20, then there's no excuse for that. Unacceptable. Mobile quarterback or not. You see the spin move there by Warren. He put a nice shake on Robert Joseph there. That's what happens. You can get a running back downfield with that great balance. Defensive back is put in a tough position to make that open field tackle. And Frank Warren showing you why he averages 5.6 yards a carry out the backfield, letting you know what he can do in space.
Going for two. 25-yard touchdown pass from Dillon to Warren. And it's 38-33. Now they're going to go for the two-point conversion. We haven't seen the Wildcat tonight, but here's Dillon going in the air, and it's caught by Bakari Maxwell for the two-point conversion. 8:06, the time remaining. We're Grambling, Louisiana. This is SWAC football. A lot of points on the board. 73 between the two teams. Get out of my way. It's crunch
time. Don't waste time. Price. Plus, use your credit card, and you'll also get.
Frank Warren, three touchdowns, two rushing, one receiving so far this evening. And in the rushing yards, 62 yards on 12 carries, almost 5 yards, a little over 5 yards of carry. And don't forget the college basketball. Early Sunday away live Friday, 2 p.m. Eastern on ESPNU. 27 points off 5 turnovers Grambling has put on the board. And what a hit put on the return man that time. That's Richard Samuel. And of course, we've been talking about Facebook. We earlier asked you what was the toughest place to travel in the Southwestern Athletic Conference or in black college football to get to, toughest place to play. Well, how many SWAC players, we're talking about the SWAC, are in the College Football Hall of Fame? College Football Hall of Fame, and can you name them?
That's too much work. But I can name a couple.
All right, we'll get you the names. Let the people at home get on Facebook and try to figure it out. And we'll tell you who they are. Ironically enough, there's more from the SWAC in the Pro Football Hall of Fame than there are in the College Football Hall of Fame.
Yeah, you told me about that one. That was surprising. That's a shocker out there. More players in the National Football League Hall of Fame than the College Football Hall of Fame.
From the SWAC. It'll be second down and 6. Arvell Nelson trying to rally his team. They're down 7 points, 7:39 to go. Low pass to Anderson, and Anderson has enough for the first down. Right at about the 42-yard line. Well, there's one that's in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Of course, Coach Eddie Robinson is a coach in the College Football, I should say, College Football Hall of Fame. Eddie Robinson, Tank Younger, played here. He's one, so, and he's from Grambling.
So he's in both.
He's in both.
I would think
No.
He's not in the NFL Hall of Fame?
No, he's in the College Football Hall of Fame, Tank Younger. Yeah, he's not in the Pro Football Hall of Fame.
Well, that's a surprise.
Robinson on the tackle.
But they get the first down. Second down. Oh, that was a first down play. Second down. Checking into the backfield is Randall Newsom. He had a big catch earlier in this contest. Standing in there is Nelson. He's going to take off and run. Kendall Robinson chasing him. And he finally hit on the near sideline. Boy, he took it. Nigel Copeland, number 8, really came up and popped him.
That's a cornerback's dream right there.
Yeah,
somebody holding up the quarterback. You'll see Nelson escape from the pocket. Once he gets outside, this is good team defense. Hold him up. Here I come.
Boom!
Corners don't get free shots like that on quarterbacks too often.
Third down, 7 now. 3-yard run for the quarterback.
Now this is what's interesting. As the game's gone on, now they're snapping the ball and they're letting the clock go down. See, this is not the hobo offense clicking on all cylinders with the high frequency of plays. They slowed it down. Now they're looking like a traditional no-huddle offense, and they seem confused.
Well, I think I don't know what they're trying to do. That's why I'm up here. Across the middle, almost picked again. And this time, getting the hand on it was Lance Castleberry, number 2. He put his hand in there.
It was like
linebacker.
It was almost like the tight end was running to him. I mean, Castleberry was at the spot where he knew where the play was coming. He was right on it, like he was the wide receiver and the tight end was the linebacker.
Well, 3 of their Texas Southern's possessions in the second half ended in turnovers, and two of those ended in points for Grambling. This time they're going to punt it away. And the punting unit is on. Solomon Stefan, I'll tell you, he has some great hang time.
Yes, he does.
Looks like he should be a candidate for the Ray Guy Award. A great punt. Professor J will join us when we come back. 5:32. The time remaining. Grambling will have the ball. They lead it by 7.
Sorry about that, folks. Just professor trying to work it out here. And speaking of weightlifting, do you know there have only been 2 men that have ever been named 8-time Mr. Olympia? One is Lee Haney. The second, Ronnie Coleman, alumnus, Grambling State University, also played football for the legendary coach, Eddie Robinson. Did you know that?
One thing I do know, you don't count too well. How do you go from 1 to 73?
How do you know I didn't do 72 or 73 there?
It started at 71, and the next number was 73.
Hey, man, you notice I was curling with my right. That's my gun. I can lift with anybody with the right arm. The left is a little suspect. But Eddie Robinson let you know the discipline of the players that he coached.
Warren trying to bounce it outside and finally brought down with a good open field tackle. Jashad Gaines on the stop defensively, number 29. And it'll bring up a second down, a gain of about 3 yards for Mr. Warren. Warren, 14 rushes, 66 yards. Coach Eddie Robb, 408 wins. What a legend. And of course, the FCS has a Coach of the Year award named after him, Eddie Robinson Award. For the FCS Coach of the Year. We got a chance to see one of the former winners last week when we were up at Northern Illinois.
Jerry Kill.
Yes, indeed.
Northern Illinois got a victory tonight.
Yes,
earlier.
Yes, they did.
He's a good coach. Coach Kill is one of those guys you can tell just born to be a coach.
And Jerry Kill won it in 2004. Last year was Mickey Matthews and Mike Farley the year before, Jerry Moore the year before him. And of course, one of the things Jerry Kill talked to us about was how proud he was to sit at the awards dinner with Eddie Robinson the year he won it.
And everybody you know that's ever come in contact with Coach Robinson, you hate to say it's boring, but all their stories are the same.
Mm-hmm.
Quality man, great American, loved his job, loved what he did. Hey, I'll take being boring if those are going to be the qualities that you mentioned in my name.
He always said to me, I had one wife, one job. Here's the quarterback, Dylan, taking off and running. Gets into the secondary. Has some running room. He will be brought down from behind, but not before he gets all the way down inside the 40-yard line. And he's still not 100% with that leg that he got hurt against Oklahoma State, because if he had been, they wouldn't have caught him.
I don't think they would have, but look at the burst here. You see here, once it opens up, good move to the outside. Poor angle taken by the free safety there, Robert Joseph. Nothing gets behind you, son, when you're playing free safety. Because of the angle, he was in chase mode. Very fortunate they were able to bring him down from behind.
36 yards on the run. His longest prior to that this season was a 21-yarder. He was a SWAC, MVP of the SWAC championship game last year against Jackson State. That is Greg Dillon. So it's first down and 10 now for the Tigers. 3:20 to go. They're in pretty good field position if they can hold on here and not make any kind of mistakes as they keep the ball on the ground, trying to run the clock down.
When you see Greg Dillon make a run like he just made there, it makes you understand why they say we can simplify the offense because he's such a talent. We can make it one to me, because the me in this case is Greg Dillon. When you got legs like that, let him use them.
So second down. .245, the clock running for Grambling State University. They lead it by 7, trying to go 6-4 for the season, 4-2 in the conference. And we've got some movement on the offense. So it's a false start.
That's a tough one. I mean, that's a crucial time there right now. You've got to think that Texas Southern was getting ready to sell out on defense. And by sell out, I mean bring all the pressure they could, leave themselves vulnerable in the secondary. Now they can kind of ease off, keep the ball in front of them, call a timeout, have the possibility of getting the ball back with some time left on the clock.
Now, Texas Southern was starting to put it together. You know, they were reeling there for a while. In this game, there's a flag down probably in the vicinity of holding. You know, they played Rutgers earlier in the year, this Texas Southern team, and they were kind of on their heels after that loss. The Rutgers, you know, they had just, and they had to do something to try to get it together. And Coach,
I wouldn't take this penalty. Sorry, keep going. But I wouldn't take this penalty given where we are in the game right now, and the clock is not your friend right now. I would decline it.
I think they did, didn't they?
Yeah, they did. Okay, that was a smart move.
Yeah, they did decline it. But anyway, they were 1-4. They had a big win against Texas College. Coach held a meeting, told them they were finished with the preseason. It's time for the new season. Let's get it together. And they responded. And they had a pretty good win. They won the last 3 ball games. You know, they struggled early. They had 15 turnovers. And again, Texas State, Rutgers, and Jackson State, just 1 turnover coming into this ball game in the last 2 ball games. But that went to pieces tonight. But let's go back to our Facebook question about the SWAC players. How many SWAC players are in the College Football Hall of Fame and name them? Well, there are 9. 9 of them. Okay. And here they are.
Walter Payton got to be on there. They're all
Buck Buchanan, Jerry Rice, Kevin Dent, Gary Big Hands Johnson, Walter Payton, Willie Richardson, Doug Williams, Paul Tank Younger.
That's a list there.
They're only
going to be a who's who.
And that's 9, and they're 11 in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. In addition to those that you see there, you've got John Stallworth, who's in the Pro Football Hall of Fame.
Yep.
Willie Brown,
yep,
from Grambling.
Yep.
Charlie Joyner. Willie Davis. Lim Barney. Jackie Slater. Ken Houston from Prairie View. Mel Blunt from Southern. I mean, that's
you can understand a couple of them, because, you know, like Willie Brown was a tight end when he was in college,
right,
and converted defensive back. Charlie Joyner was more of a little wing back, I believe, while he was here. So you can understand some of that, but there should be more representation than 9, you would think.
Option to the left side for Dillon.
Still on the ball carrier for the Grambling Tigers.
We should be another timeout called here. If you're Texas Southern, use your last one here. You know, because I would like to think
If you call timeout now and you get the ball back, you can control when you stop the clock by killing it if you get first downs. But if you let the clock wind down for those 30 seconds, you never get them back.
Well, let's look at what's coming up on the U on Saturday. There's what he's done.
Seems there with those two losses, and I think LSU heads up the pack.
So a punting situation. So still an opportunity for Texas Southern. Remember, they only have one timeout remaining. Grambling has two left, but more importantly, Texas Southern is the one that needs to put some points on the board. And this is a pretty good punt. This one goes out of bounds right inside, right at the 10-yard line, and that's where Texas Southern will go to work their market right outside the 10 with 1:45 to go in our coverage of men's basketball. They were down 23-6 at one point in this ball game. Here's a pass, and it's complete on the far sideline to Dixon. Ricky Dixon on the reception. He goes out of bounds after a gain across the 15 to the 16-yard line. Gain of 5.
Yeah, I like that. You know, so often we always say the most important play, I always say, the most important play in a two-minute offense is the first play. Getting a completion, getting your offense going. Good job by Texas Southern. Don't you have the feeling we're just in for a very interesting ending here?
Yeah.
It's not going to be the normal ending we you normally see. This is going to get interesting.
I'm going to make everybody mad. Hey, we could be looking at overtime. Here's Gilbert. Up to the 30, first down.
See, this is what I mean. In college football, once they get that first down, the clock stops for a while, and they're so used to getting the ball snapped right away. A minute and 30 is plenty of time for Texas Southern.
They stop it till they move the chains. Once the chains are set, they wind the clock, and there is the quarterback, Nelson. He can't afford to take a sack. He takes it down.
That's close.
37, 38-yard line.
That's going to cost them 10, 15 seconds there because they got to get situated and they got to spot the ball, and he did get
but
the first down.
But there's a player down, and that's a Grambling player that's injured. That's Exuma, the man who had an interception earlier. He's a little slow getting up. And going back to that Hall of Fame thing, we were talking about the college football and the Hall of Fame. Of course, there's been a black college football Hall of Fame that's been kind of set up by two former Grambling players, Shaq Harris and Doug Williams, and they're going to have the initial induction. That's going to be in Atlanta on the February 13th. And, you know, some people...
I nominate Charlie Neal.
Well, that's nice of you. I appreciate that. But, you know, you got to look at Mel Blount and Charlie Brackens, who was a quarterback at Prairie View, and Robert Brazil from Jackson State, Willie Davis and Buck Buchanan from Grambling, and Elsie Greenwood, Jackie Slater, people like that. To possibly go in his first induction.
You're going to put a couple, I mean, I didn't hear a MEAC name in there at all.
Eddie Robinson is one that has to
go. Is there going to be a MEAC representative in there?
I didn't say it wouldn't. I'm just calling out some names, a possibility. Good defensive play by Tristan Anthony. He just tripped him up, tripped up the quarterback.
That was when you had to have a play, and you need your playmaker to make a play.
Justice is served here.
Yeah, don't give up outside contain. He almost took the bait and went inside, but he got back outside, make the tackle. Oh, you can't do that.
Intercepted. He threw it away.
Guess who has it?
Christian Anthony headed to the end zone. Would he make it? No. He's down at the 2.
I told you the ending. You just saw it. You saw the ending wasn't going to be your normal ending.
Christian Anthony has run 2 touchdowns, interceptions back for touchdowns this year, and he was trying to make it number 3, and he just couldn't get in. Stumbling, bumbling, and gets to the 2.
He was stepping. He didn't worry about the DB, but he forgot about the offensive lineman. He was so worried on the outside. Look at, you knew the quarterback got in trouble, Nelson. He was looking at the pass rush instead of looking down the field, the secondary. And you see Anthony see the defender. He's so worried looking at the defensive back on his left side, he forgot about the center that was trailing him from the inside.
And he'll be back next year.
Can he win the Thorpe Award?
He could win anything.
To the best defensive back with all these interceptions he has. I mean,
he could win anything he wants to right now.
For the Thorpe Award.
37 seconds to go. No timeouts left for Texas Southern. There's Walker to the right side. Touchdown. So Walker put some points on the board.
Yeah, surprised they're putting the points on the board. I would have.
Well, they
taken a knee. Why not? I mean,
well, they did
trying to get style points.
They did throw it.
they didn't throw it, but
Christian Anthony, 5 tackles, 2 for loss, an interception, 2 forced fumbles, and almost a partridge in a pear tree. He was getting there. Give him some pecans, Jay.
Yeah, he deserved it.
Point after is good. Rod Broadway got a chance to talk to him a little bit yesterday after their practice. And I'll tell you, the turnovers for Texas Southern, 6, and it's resulted in 34 points for Grambling.
But once Texas Southern figures out a way to eliminate the turnovers and cut down on the penalties, this is going to be a good football team. I mean, don't let this score fool you or anything else. This Texas Southern team, they're building for the future. And I would